The heat is on the racers of the NHRA. This is the final event, and it pushes them over the line. Jack Beckman feels the pressure. He blew his funny car to pieces in qualifying, but then came back and still leads the points. In a few minutes, Antron Brown will start the path that could lead to his first championship. Already, two champions have been crowned. Eddie Krawick with his third, and Alan Johnson his first. It's time to go racing at Pomona. This is the final day of the NHRA season. The likable Antron Brown has a marginal lead in Top Fuel, but if he can win two rounds of eliminations, he will be the first African-American to win an NHRA championship. Alan Johnson has dominated in pro stock all year. Yesterday, the 17-year veteran finally got his first career championship. The closest race is in funny car. Jack Beckman starts the day 2 points ahead of Ron Capps. The DSR teammates battle each other for their first championship trophy. The funny car and Top Fuel titles are still to be decided, and you will be a witness to history.
Now you are a witness to how the funny car point leader Jack Beckman's weekend began as you go on board in Thursday qualifying. A major explosion, but no big deal as this team overcame that to qualify third and hold on to the point lead in what will be a round-by-round basis today in final eliminations. Well, if you know fast Jack Beckman, overcoming the odds is really no big deal. He got a brand new sponsor, a brand new car, a brand new crew, and a brand new crew chief just 17 races ago, and despite that, he is still in the position he is in. Also keep in mind, Jack Beckman won the biggest challenge of his life when he defeated cancer 8 years ago. It does not matter what cards are dealt to this man. He believes that he has a team today that can overcome the odds once again.
No question, it's a painful reminder for Ron Capps, now in his 18th season of Nitro competition, that he's yet to win a championship. He has been close. 3 times he was runner-up to the number one spot. He comes into this event riding the momentum of a career 38th win just 2 weeks ago in Las Vegas, trying to parlay that now into a very memorable day. But he struggled this weekend in qualifying. In fact, going to the final session yesterday, he was in the 16th and final spot. But then he vaulted to the number one position as he laid down an amazing 4-second pass. Now, Capps and his team trying to parlay that type of performance into a grand day, where at the end of this day, he will be holding on to a championship trophy for the first time. Our marquee matchup in Top Fuel, Antron Brown against Spencer Massey. Spencer Massey, who came within 4/1000ths of a second of winning a championship a year ago, trying to atone today. And for more on that matchup, let's check in with John Kernan.
Gary, could there be a reason for concern in Antron Brown's camp? Final round of qualifying on Saturday afternoon, they broke a piston. Big explosion. And now as Antron gets ready to face his teammate and title contender Spencer Massey in this marquee matchup, Antron, we have to wonder, after what happened last night, is there any concern in your part?
No, not at all, man. I believe in 100% in the team that I'm on, and very blessed to be with this group of guys on this Matco car. I mean, they make it happen. They work so hard all year long, and they're very deserving of this, and Lord knows that. And we're just going to go out here and do what we do. I mean, I'm just happy that it happened in the last round of qualifying instead of on race day today. So it gives us another shot to go out there and get it. We all have great parts. They put it back together. The old Matco hot rod sound good in the pits this morning, and we're ready to go out there on that racetrack.
Well, he is ready to go, and he controls his own destiny with 2 round wins. Antron Brown will be the champion.
Well, and 5 feet away, quiet and contemplative, is Spencer Massey, his first round opponent. And Spencer, after the bitter disappointment of losing a championship last year by 4th, we heard Gary Gerald talk about that at the show. We know the countdown has not gone exactly the way you wanted it to. Despite all of that, you have an opportunity today to get yourself right back into this. What are you thinking about right now?
Well, right now, obviously, I just want to think about winning this championship. But before we do that, we have to beat Antron. And that's a tough customer over there because he's been killer throughout all season and in the countdown. But right now, we're in the best position that we could be in to win the championship. I say all we have to do is just win the race. That's all we got to do. But it's tough. It's Top Fuel racing out here. But whew, it's fun.
Nervous?
Well, you know, if I'm not nervous, if I said I wasn't nervous, I'd be lying. But, you know, that's the name of the game. We get put pressure on us, and we better step up and do our A game, because that's why Don Schumacher has me and Antron and his son Tony. We're 1, 2, 3 in points, and we're going to have fun no matter what today.
The mantra today, got to go Caddyshack. Spencer Massey just trying to be the ball.
Be the ball.
Be the ball.
Snow-capped sentinels look down on Pomona, California, where NHRA champions are made. There have been some thrilling moments at this track, owing in part to the race at the end of the season and the battle for the championship. But Mike Dunn, since drag racing was born here in Southern California, much of its history has been made right here.
And most of that history has been made at the final event here in the finals. And much of that history has been made by Tony Schumacher. Now, Antoine Brown comes in as a points leader, but he has really struggled. If those struggles continue, watch out for Tony Schumacher. He knows how to win on Sunday, come from behind to get those championships. The question is, does he have the car? Well, guess what? I wouldn't bet against him.
Well, Spencer Massey already suiting up, getting ready to go. They will be, Antron Brown and Spencer, the second pair out. So they'll come up very quickly. Antron is ready as well. You look at the points. It's a big day in Top Fuel. And now take a look at this. This is a camera on the helmet of skydiver Jason Peters, bringing the American flag into the track. It's an NHRA tradition, and the crowd loves every minute of it. The first pair on the line, and the engines begin to fire. Bob Vandergriff is fired. Here comes Steve Torrence. Top Fuel, first round of eliminations. Spencer Massey and Antron Brown coming up as second pair. Oh, man, this is it. At the Auto Club Raceway at Pomona, Auto Club of Southern California Finals, this will determine the Nitro champion right here and today.
Now, Paul and Mike, you want to talk about an electric moment. As the anthem came to a close and Jason Peters landed, all the crowd was on its feet as the cars came to life, and it really sets the scene here in Southern California, the birthplace of drag racing. And a racetrack today that's at 85 degrees. It's been greatly prepared by the safety safari, who's done a great job all year long in trying to create racetracks and lanes that are equal. And right now, they're about as equal as they can be. You're going to find drivers with lane choice pick the left. You're going to find them as well, like Spencer Massey. The big matchup we've got coming up next, as he takes on Antron Brown, he's going to select the right lane. Going to be a fun
Lucas Oil ladder. Tony Schumacher and J.R. Todd. Brown in race round number one. And a loss by Antron, and Tony can end up being the champion yet again. Torrence is out of it. Vandergriff is going to give the track a good test. He runs a 381 at 324 miles an hour to become our first winner of the day. Now, there's the information that'll go back all through the staging lanes. What is this track like?
Well, look at the tire shake. As we said, Steve Torrence had the lane choice. He picked the right lane. You saw the tires just shaking back and forth from side to side. Smokes the tires. He catches it pretty quick, but he didn't let it settle down quite enough. Gets back on the throttle, spins it again. Wasn't going to matter anyway because Bob Vandergriff was hooked up and run a 381 to get him into the second round.
Tony Schumacher, as he gets ready back in the staging lanes to face J.R. Todd, they will be the sixth pair to come to the line. And here is the first big test. Spencer Massey and Antron Brown. This starts the end of the battle for the championship. Massey, it's simple. He loses, he's out of the title race. Spencer won the Winter Nationals over Antron Brown. And Antron Brown, he can lose this round and still win the championship, but he won't control his own destiny.
And you saw that head-to-head matchup with Spencer Massey, 10-9 there, 5-4 with Antron leading this season, but he's 2-0 in final rounds against Spencer Massey. This is your number 7 and your number 10 qualifier. Remember, 6 thousandths of a second separated them in qualifying. That gives Spencer Massey the lane choice. He has taken the right-hand lane.
Quick note on Spencer Massey, racing with purpose today, more than just trying to win the championship. He does not have a deal for next year yet. No sponsor, but Don Schumacher told him not to worry. However, I think he is.
And a quick note on Brian Kiradi, the crew chief for Antoine Brown. Everybody from top to bottom in these organizations feeling the pressure right now. Now imagine if your 24-year-old son, Nick, shows up unannounced, surprises his dad on Sunday morning, and then drops this bombshell on him. Hey, Dad, me and my girlfriend, Monica, we're getting married. Brian Kiradi is on tilt right now.
As if there is not enough pressure, it is bearing down on the line. Spencer Massey and Antoine Brown. But it just became a lot harder to win the championship. What a surprise. Go on board, Antoine.
You can see right here, the thing just backfires. Looked like it pushed the head gasket out, might have backfired the supercharger. Spencer Massey had to backpedal that car to get the round win. Well, that's just a tough break for Antoine right there.
And for Tato Kahara, round one, you're through to the second round. How did you approach the tune-up in this pressure background?
You know, we try not to deviate from what we've been doing all year long. It got it this far. We're just trying to continue what we've been doing.
You selected the right lane. What made that choice for you?
We ran Q1 in that right lane, and we had some data on it. You know, with the rain out, we missed one session. So we thought that was our best choice.
Antoine Brown, it looks like he may be hurt. He's got some fuel down the front of his uniform, don't you think?
Oh, yeah, it looks like his fire suit was burnt there. Watch right side of your screen. It's going to backfire as he's going along. It shoots the point. Look at the fire there. There's fuel going in that cockpit, I think, is what happened. Boy, that's a bad deal. Let's take a look at Spencer Massey on his run, though. He had to actually backpedal the race car. We saw Steve Torrance right before him go out there and rattle the tires and smoke. Same thing happened. Look at the tires are rattling there for Spencer. Look at him. He catches it right there. Boom. Pops it right away. Now, the quicker you catch it, the less you have to do. Spencer caught it very quick. It recovered. He was able to run a 391 and get the win. Now let's go on board with Antoine slow-mo. You can see the backfire. Something comes out of the back of the engine, you know, as far as a little flame there. And then at that point, the fuel must be going up towards the front. It's going to catch on fire and get in that cockpit. You see the fire going there. Ooh, man, that was.
And he really jumped on the brakes. And that is the reason that Tony Schumacher, his teammate, has the canopy on the car. I bet you see him on all three cars next year.
Now, there's a situation where Antoine didn't think anything was wrong. See where it's burnt on the legs of his suit. And he could. Initially, he wasn't too worried. He just thought, okay, the run's done. He was kind of taking his time, and then you see him try to hurry up because it was getting plenty warm in there.
His wife, Billy Joe, trying to get up to the ambulance. They watch from the starting line, and you saw them run up. He was trying to get water down the front of the suit to help him. He pulled it off then. And look at this. He just flings it over the wall. Spencer Massey. If he can win this race, as we said, then he can win the championship. But there's a long way to go, Gary.
Indeed, Paul. And as we stand with Spencer Massey, and he is, of course, concerned about Antoine, his teammate, and if he is okay, yet to be determined. The opportunity, the door just got opened a little bit wider. There was pressure before. How much more is it magnified? Because you know, if you win this event today, you're a champion.
No, you're exactly right. I mean, there's tons of pressure. I mean, that first round was the most critical run of the season. And now we have three more. Hopefully, that's going to be just as much pressure. It's unbelievable that we actually have the shot. I mean, who would have thought that Antoine would have blown up like that? Hopefully, he's okay, and hopefully, he didn't get burned or whatever the situation is. I hate seeing something like that. I wanted to be a good close drag race, but ours went out and shook and smoked the tires, and I pedaled it once and tried feathering, but I think I just went wide open with it and got it hooked up and got the wind light. But, boy, more importantly, I want to make sure Antron's okay, but hopefully he is, and then hopefully I can turn on three wind lights today.
Off of his left shoulder, there's a championship trophy that's only 20 yards away, but there are three more rounds of competition separating Spencer Massey from that reward.
So just two pairs down. It's been great so far. Tony Schumacher now climbs in, pulls the canopy down, and if it goes right, then he and Spencer Massey may meet in the final. Whoever wins that wins the championship.
Southern California. Snow-capped mountains, the smell of nitro. It must be Pomona. NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing.
ESPN's presentation of the Automobile Club of Southern California Finals is brought to you by Full Throttle Energy Drink. Grab a Full Throttle Energy Drink and feel the energy at work. The Auto Club, we're always with you. And Lucas Oil, the world leader of high-performance lubricants and problem-solving additives for everyday cars and trucks. You don't see this very often. This isn't qualifying on Friday, and it's Tony Schumacher. And it's time for a Lincoln Tech Fix It Pit Report.
Well, what's happening here on that Army car is it's pushing out a head gasket. It loses that cylinder pressure inside that combustion chamber. Tony went a 380 elapsed time, but he was only running 307 miles per hour. When he had it on eight cylinders in the final session, he went 325 at the stripe.
And here once again is what happened to Antron Brown when it caught fire and fuel went in the cockpit.
And you see it backfire and the fuel went in the cockpit, and it was a fuel fire. So I got to believe it's a fuel line possibly broke, caused the engine to go lean, backfired, and then lit that fire. That was pretty warm there for Antron, though.
Status now, John Kernan.
Antron Brown is now being checked out in the infield care center behind the grandstands. He was brought in. Both hands were wrapped, and which would indicate burns there. I asked him quickly if he was okay. He told me, yes, I am fine. However, got a look at the fire suit that he was wearing, and it did its job. The first layer, the fire burned through that, but the Nomex layer underneath and the other layers were just fine, and that was on the area of his right calf. But Antron says he is okay right now. They're checking him out now.
And we wish him well. Morgan Lucas and Mike Salinas. Lucas, only one round win at the last three countdown races.
There's an upset.
How about that? Mike Salinas is going into the second round. He qualified with a career best ET, looking to win his first ever round of racing, and Mike Salinas has got it done. How great for him.
Take another look at it. We've seen that right-hand lane. Cars got there shaking the tires and spinning. Look at Mike Salinas. He gets a win, no parachute, and he even gets it stopped on this short racetrack here at the Pomona Fairgrounds.
And just two pairs, that man, Tony Schumacher, will take to the track. Our Geico Tractionary, the run, 2006.
Considered by many the greatest single run in NHRA history, Tony Schumacher had to set the national ET record and win the race to win the championship. And we take you back to the final round as Doug Coletta watches on to see if he was going to win. And nope, he didn't. The frustration on his face as Tony Schumacher wins the championship.
And this could be a day that he does it yet again. On the line, Brandon Bernstein and Terry McMillan. Brandon's trying to end a 69-race winless streak. McMillan, last-round win on the tour came at Bristol 13 races ago. McMillan lights the tires, and Brandon Bernstein
Look
goes down track. 377
nice
with a six. That is low of the round. 323 miles an hour. Brandon Bernstein has a very hot car this weekend.
Well, I'll tell you what, he definitely does. While he went on board with Terry McMillan there, and all he could do was watch Brandon Bernstein pull away. Everybody having problems in that right-hand lane, but Brandon went right down the track. Great job.
Corey McLenathan and Sean Langdon are coming up next, but we're looking at the pair coming up behind them because that is Tony Schumacher, who will face J.R. Todd as we look at the mini ladder and where it may go when we end up in round two. but we're still in round one. Let's go to John Kernan.
Well, and Tony Schumacher certainly says his team responds to pressure situations. Well, now that Antoine Brown, the points leader, is out, the pressure is on for them to go through and win this race. Talking with his crew chief, Mike Green, he says he's not sure why the pressure brings out the best of that whole team. He says possibly it's because these guys have been together for a while. They've won a title together, so they've been there before, kind of like been here, done that. So they have a lot of confidence when the pressure is on.
So there they are, Sean Langdon and Corey McLenathan. We're talking the number one qualifier in Sean Langdon for Allen-Nabe Racing. And are we going to see another upset? Yes, we are. Wow, what a day this has become. Upset after upset. Sean Langdon is taken down by Corey McLenathan.
You saw
can't believe this.
Alan Johnson just shaking his head. He had lane choice. He took the left-hand lane. Now, I don't think that was a bad move because we saw cars go right down the left-hand lane. We didn't see any cars go down the right until we saw Brandon Bernstein. So I don't think the lane had anything to do with it. They just missed on the setup. Sean went out there and spun the tires, as did Corey. Corey did a better job of getting his car to recover. And as a result, he advanced to the second round by taking out the number one qualifier.
Back at the line, there is Tony Schumacher, who is about to face J.R. Todd. If Tony Schumacher can go on from this round and win the race, he can win the championship, but there is so much yet to come. This one, as you see right there, it's a must-win. J.R. Todd, three of his six Top Fuel race wins have come over Tony Schumacher. Schumacher, nine-time Indy winner. Only two race wins in 2012, but obviously still has a shot at the championship. I ask his team, what's the best thing they have going? The answer was, we have Tony Schumacher.
Well, I tell you what, it's a pretty even match up here. You consider the track conditions. Guys struggling in both lanes, but are getting down both lanes. You see Tony Schumacher entering the finals, points down in 2006, 45, and then 67 in 2007. He won both of those championships. So we know that he's able to do it. He's 67 points behind now, but his focus is, I just got to win the race. If I win the race, I'm the champion.
Look at the eyes, too. He looks very confident. That team's looked confident all weekend long. Track temperature at 85 degrees, air temperature 63 degrees. Still very cool, but sunshine on the track.
Well, with Tony Schumacher, you go on board with him. J.R. Todd really races him tough. And the situation where the lanes are pretty much even, there's problems in both lanes, the cars have gone down. The fact that they've only been 300ths of a second separation in qualifying, this could be tough.
What can make the ultimate difference is the fact that Mike Green, the crew chief for Tony Schumacher, did not get greedy last night, did not go after the record. The car hasn't been what they wanted it to be, but they got it worked out. They now have a car that can go the distance today. So that could be a pretty big move, not going after the record last night.
Wow, was that good. Tony Schumacher just edges out J.R. Todd, 376 with a six. And J.R. Todd runs a career best run, a 379 with a nine, and loses.
Both drivers did their job. J.R. Todd had a hundredth of a second advantage off the starting line. I thought he might hold it off, but the Sarge, Mike Green, put a great tune-up on that Army car. He was able to drive around him on a great 376 past a 324-mile-per-hour. Take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam. By about a quarter car length, the U.S. Army car advances to the next round.
Intervals down the track. J.R. got off the line first, but then Tony took over after 60 feet and took the win. I remind you, back in 07, we talk about, can Tony Schumacher come from behind? 2007, he went into the race 67 points behind.
And what did he do? He went on and won the race and won the championship over Hot Rod Fuller.
And funny car is coming up in just a moment, and that too is a battle for the championship. Jack Beckman leads the points at this moment, but just a few back is Ron Capps, trying not to be the bridesmaid for the fourth time in his career. Back in Pomona, the Auto Club of Southern California Finals, part of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. Doug Coletta and Khaled Belushi are on the line now. Coverage of Monday Night Football continues on ESPN. First at 6:30, it's Monday Night Countdown, served by Applebee's. And then it will be the Chiefs as they face off against the Steelers. Monday Night Football, Kansas City versus Pittsburgh, 8:30 on ESPN. Belushi and Coletta. Coletta's up in smoke. Khaled Belushi, who got his first win at Maple Grove this year, gets it down the track. 377, 227 miles an hour.
Coletta had a huge advantage off the starting line. You saw that reaction time, and then went right up in smoke. Khaled Belushi, though, he was driving almost into the wall. Kept it off of there. If he would have hit the wall before the finish line, he would have been disqualified, but he was able to hang on.
With Tony Schumacher at the top end of the racetrack, how much do you thrive on situations like this?
Well, I'll tell you what, I hope the next three cars I race, they don't start. Because I've lived this moment a lot. And I'm going to go to the Mayo Clinic this year and have my heart checked. Now, this is for anybody to live one of these moments. But as many as we've had, couldn't ask for any more. Woke up this morning, it's Veterans Day, and we're in this miraculous position we've been in so many times with the right team. See, I don't want to do it with my five high school friends working on it, but the nine guys working on my car, I want to do it with these guys because they're the best in the world. I don't trust my nine high school friends, man. I've surrounded myself with guys that are capable of this moment, like our Army soldiers, and for Veterans Day to be falling on this miraculous day, it's just beautiful. I mean, I am so blessed to have this chance again.
Thanks.
You bet. David Grubnik, Clay Milliken complete their burnouts, and we turn our attention now to the chase in funny car. And we know this man, Fast Jack Beckman, loves to overcome adversity, but he did tell me just a little bit ago that he would give up his left eyebrow to win this championship. That is what happened in that big explosion on Thursday. You seem to be pretty loose, are you?
It's a lot of pressure. I mean, the moment is enormous. I'm trying to step away from it and just be a funny car driver right now. I mean, ultimately, overthinking it and worrying about it isn't going to help you perform the job the way that you've done. And the same for the crew guys. They just got to make sure they pull the wrenches the same every time, keep their heads in the game. We've got to do things perfect, and we have to be really smart. This is going to be a long day, we hope, and it's going to be a rewarding day, we think, for the Valvoline Next Gen team.
Race is the Tequila Patron car you see right behind him. And, guys, it's the human element always because the car doesn't know it's racing for a championship.
And back to Top Fuel, David Grubnik, the Topeka winner. He lost first round at the last two countdown races on the tour. He goes up against that man, Clay Milliken. His last round win at Pomona was here in 2005.
This is our final pair of Top Fuel dragsters in the first round. Like I said, the track conditions were pretty tricky in the beginning, but it looks like both lanes are coming around pretty well. We're seeing some good runs towards the end of the session. That bodes well for Funny Car Championship battles coming up.
Where's this going? Can you believe that? Oh, once again. I mean, it turned into a quasi-pedal fest, and it's won by Clay Milliken. I can't believe it.
How about J.R. Todd? He runs a 379. Could be pretty much anybody in this round except for maybe Schumacher and Burns' team, but this is another classic thing. But kind of tells me the window's pretty much narrow for the tuning ability on these cars. And you have to hit it pretty good. It'll go down and run the number. But if you miss it, you're not going down the track.
Well, as we take a look at the Lucas Oil ladder, the word is that Antoine Brown will be released from the care center shortly. Schumacher and Khaled Belushi, DSR versus Alan Abi. Don Schumacher versus his former Uber crew chief, Alan Johnson.
The other side, the driver that has a chance for the championship will be Spencer Massey. But Brandon Bernstein is going to have lane choice in that matchup.
And earlier, well, the three contenders in Funny Car, as Funny Car is coming up, they gathered around that trophy that they want to win. Ron, put the thing back, will you please? There has been a lot of drama in Funny Car this weekend. Todd Lysenko and his explosion and the fact that the body actually pulled the car off the ground, then the parachutes deployed. That was incredible. And then our points leader, Jack Beckman, during qualifying. This was also a huge explosion. But you know what? Both teams responded, got their cars back, and ready to run at the Automobile Club of Southern California Finals. Oh, beautiful clouds. A little stop-action photography there at the Auto Club of Southern California Finals over the mountains, not that far from the track here at Pomona. Well, Mike Neff, he's warming up. He is, it's a long chance, but it's mathematically possible for him today.
That's going to be tough, though. You'd have to put a national record into it, and I don't think the conditions are there for it, but mathematically, as you said, he still has a shot.
First pair up will be Jim Head and Tim Wilkerson. As we look at the Lucas Oil ladder, Ron Capps controls his own destiny. He wins the race, and he wins the championship. He starts number one in the quickest funny car field ever.
Other side of the ladder, Jack Beckman in that battle. His first round matchup is going to be Alexis DeJoria.
But right now, let's take a look at Jim Head. His 399th race day start in top two over funny car. Qualified with a career best run of 403. He faces Tim Wilkerson, still without a race win since last year's race at Seattle. And they both light him. We got a pedal fest. Head gets close to the wall. Wow. Wilkerson takes the win.
Jeez.
You believe that?
I tell you what, like I said before, it wasn't pretty, but it was fun to watch. Take a look at this. I mean, it was a close race. Both drivers spun the tires initially right about the same time. And then you look at it, looked like Head might have hit the wall there. It doesn't matter. Tim Wilkerson got to the finish line first by 200ths of a second.
Earlier, Dave Reif caught up with Ron Capps.
First salvo in the Funny Car Championship is going to come in the third pair when Ron Capps comes up. And Ron, it's the same old situation, Motley Crue pun intended there, but it's a different year, different emotions.
Yeah, it's such a culmination right now, such a lot of things that happened this year, and I'm so pumped up. I'm such a good place mentally. I know Ron Tober is and Napa guys are. We've been, you know, going between Metallica and Pennywise and some other good Stone Sour's new album, and that's what gets my crew going and gets me going. And we're trying to enjoy this like the fans are, but at the same time, we got to stay focused. So we'll see what we can do.
Tony Pedregon is his first-round opponent.
Think about this, Mike. In Top Fuel, we had four upsets. The first pair down in Funny Car is an upset. Now, here comes Courtney Force and Matt Hagan, and Ron Capps is going to be right after that.
Well, let me tell you, as a driver in this situation, I would be nervous. And it sounds like both Ron and Jack in their interviews are possibly a little bit, and that's normal. They're professionals, the body comes down. But the thing is, with all of these cars struggling to get down the racetrack, now as a driver, you have to put on that cap. Okay, I may have to backpedal this car. I may have to save it to try to get that round win. It kind of takes away the focus of just going up there and just hitting the tree, getting a good light, knowing pretty much that your car is going to go down the racetrack. It tends to make you just a little bit more nervous going up the line.
Matt Hagan, Courtney Force. Matt just a few minutes away now from ending his championship run. Courtney Force has one win over Hagan in three finals. She made every starting lineup this year as a rookie. That's pretty good. Hagan's off first, but where is it? It goes to Courtney Force.
She drove around.
Come from behind. 405, 318 miles an hour to Hagan's 408. This girl's got it, doesn't she?
Oh, yeah. I mean, Matt Hagan had a good reaction time. He was a little over a hundredth of a second quicker off the starting line. But Courtney just drove right around. Watch it. Kept it right in the groove. Everybody else struggling. Both these cars went right down the middle. Take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam by 13 thousandths of a second. Courtney gets the win.
Well, they're on the line. They're ready. Ron Capps and Tony Pedregon as Capps now begins his march to a championship. Jack Beckman strapped in, points leader in Funny Car at the Auto Club of Southern California Finals, part of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. He'll be coming up in just a moment, but a key matchup coming up on the line shortly. Ron Capps and Tony Pedregon.
Hey, I'm nervous right at this point because we could definitely see the championship decided right here in the first round with what we're seeing on that racetrack with the conditions the way they are. Now, Ron Capps and Jack Bettman, two very good race cars that are normally very consistent, but we've seen them have their problems in the last few races. So, I mean, I'm hanging on the edge of my seat.
You looked at Ron Capps, been trying to win the Funny Car Championship 16 years, three times bridesmaid. Is this the day? This is a must-win round for Ron Capps. Let's look at career second-place finishes. 98, 2000, 2005. Stat guy?
Let's talk about Don Schumacher, the guy who assembled this great team. If he wins a round of racing in Funny Car, Jack Beckman or Ron Capps, he knocks out Mike Knepp, and that will guarantee the double championship in Top Fuel in Funny Car. He did that in 2005 with Tony Schumacher and Gary Selzy. How many championships for the Don? How about number 11?
And when it comes to Ron Capps, I talked to Ron Tobler, his crew chief. They put the car back in the trailer following their dominating Vegas win and brought the same one here. He said it took two qualifying sessions to kind of get the tune-up for the differences in altitude figured out. In the third session, they were going down the racetrack just fine before a mechanical gremlin bit them. But they feel, once again, that he has a great handle on this race car. And we all know what happens when Ron Tobler gets a great handle on a race car. Watch out. And one quick sponsorship note, after 7 years on the side of the Pedregon cars, the Herzog family. Family will be stepping away to focus on some family racing next year.
Ron Tober steps away from the line. Capps and Pedregon. Jack Beckman watching from the staging lane in his car. It doesn't get any more tension in an event than this. Must win for Capps. That's not even a one. Eyes closed, contemplating. Right at the last, 409, 311 miles an hour. Ron Capps has done what he needs to do. He has taken down Tony Pedregon in the first round.
Boy, it was close, though. Tony had the advantage off of the starting line, 069 to 083, and then Ron Capps had to drive around. Ron Tober, nice tune-up on that car, 409, 311. Might have took Tony Pedregon a little bit lightly, but you take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam by just less than a car length. Ron Capps advances to the second round.
And as he was coming right at us, I wasn't sure that he was going to get it done. Dave Reif.
Well, Ron Tobler, we got to watch it right here on the NHRA vision screen, and that one looked a little closer than it needed to be. Did you leave anything on the table as far as tune-up goes?
Well, you know, we've seen a lot of cars smoke the tires out here today, so we were just trying to be careful and make sure that we went, and it got the job done.
Now, Jack Beckman, they're getting him ready. He'll be up shortly. If he loses this first round matchup, then Ron Capps will finally get his championship. I bet hearts are pounding here. They're pounding at the line. I know they're pounding in the booth.
Grant Downing, Cruz Pedregon, next pair of funny cars, first round of eliminations in the season finale at Pomona. Here's Ron Capps, who climbs out of the car, looks around at all the cameras and says, something special going on? You tell us.
Yeah, I don't know what all this attention is, Gary. What a deal, man. I'm in the right lane, so as I'm staging the car, across my tree is this packed Pomona grandstand. And then there's an airplane flying in, and it's a weird, surreal feeling to be here at this track and have a shot like this. I know I've been here three times in the past, but Napa guys, Oakley, Dodge Charger, Valvoline, all the sponsors, but this is fun, man. This is what you dream about as a kid. This is everything, and here we are. And I remember Selzy being down here and winning it and almost falling down. You know, I hope good things happen for Jack and that crew, but we're fighting for a championship, so I wouldn't be too hurt if they lose.
Thanks.
Ron Capps. That's Cruz Pedregon and Grant Downing. Look at this. He's so excited. He kisses the safety safari guy. You know, grab everyone you can. But be careful, Ron. Well, this is a huge moment. Cruz Pedregon, still winless this season. And Grant Downing, native of New Zealand, starts a career best. driving the Worsham car.
Well, and he ran a career best 410 in lap time on Friday and then didn't even run yesterday. Cruz Pedregon, I'll tell you what, he made two very nice passes yesterday. Four flats, a four flat with a nine, a four flat with an eight to be in the number two qualifying spot.
Downing's out. Cruz Pedregon easily to a first round win.
Not the supercharger.
Yeah, you see the supercharger? Yeah. So Cruz Pedregon has his win with a 4:19. And when we come back, Jack Beckman will be on the line. A must-win situation as he faces Alexis DeJoria.
I'm an American soldier, an American.
Hi, I'm Greg Biffle, driver number 16, 3M Ford Fusion. And I'd like to thank all the veterans on this Veteran Day, men and women serving home and abroad that has defended our country.
Well, ESPN is joining the USO to give the USO wish book to send gifts that will lift the spirits of our troops and their families on this Veterans Day and Veterans Day weekend. Jack Beckman, far side, is a veteran of the United States Air Force. You're on board with Jack. Alexis DeJoria is in the other lane. And again, Mike, we are talking must win for Jack Beckman now, if he wants a championship. Alexis DeJoria, of course, a rookie this year. Most NHRA wins without an NHRA championship. Ron Capp sitting right there with 38.
Pelly's sounding real good right now.
Pelly's sounding really good.
Well, it's only going to win if Fast Jack gets beat by Alexis DeJoria. Now, it's interesting to note that Jack Beckman has taken that left-hand lane. Like I say, I don't think there's a real big difference in the lane. We've seen good runs, and we've seen tires shake it in both lanes. Alexis DeJoria in the other lane, she struggled in qualifying. She made one good run to qualify in that number 14 spot. Fast Jack, though, I think had a little bit better of a car. Well, not a little bit, definitely had a better car in qualifying. They did spin the tires yesterday on both their runs down track, but they were definitely pushing it to see what the track would hold.
Yeah, but Jack Beckman has just one round win here in the last 3 years. This drag strip has not favored Jack Beckman. Alexis last won a round of racing 9 races ago. She's 1-6 racing Beckman. Does that mean she's going to lose, or does that mean she's good?
Look at like you said, Fast Jack doesn't do very well here, but he's done well against Alexis. But, I mean, the key is Fast Jack, I don't believe, has ever had as good of a race car that he has right now on the starting line at this race.
Absolutely right. So does the championship go on, or does Ron Capps win if Jack Beckman fails here? Jack Beckman, he's going to have the win. The championship goes on.
Nice run.
4:03 is the run. Low of the round, 317 miles an hour. You said he had the car. He absolutely has the car.
How about that? I mean, Jack was a little conservative on the tree, didn't push at all. You knew he was in a shallow one to get the elapsed time. And boy, the elapsed time came up on the board. Todd Smith put a nice tune-up on that thing, goes right down the racetrack, a 4:03. It wasn't real aggressive low, it was good, but boy, it was pulling through the middle. 268 miles per hour at the eighth mile. They were throwing it to it in the middle of the racetrack where they knew the track was good. On board with Alexis, you saw right in that shake zone, just rattled the tires and went up in tire smoke, and that was the end of her weekend.
And back in the pits, Ron Tobler, when he heard the result of that matchup, was kind of, guys, we got to get back to work. So Jack Beckman has done what he needs to do, and the points are now back with Jack Beckman, the leader, and Ron Capps 2 points behind. Mike Neff, he's going away. Gary Gerald.
Jack Beckman, it's punch, it's counterpunch. Is it fun?
No. Fun is when the wind light comes on and the parachutes come out. It's exciting, it's anxiety, it's a lot of emotion. fun's hopefully going to be at the end of the day when I can replace the full throttle cam with a Wally or maybe two. The Valvoline team, it's just amazing. And so is the Napa team. And so for Mike Neff, I think we just aced Neff out of the championship, and it's down to our two cars. And it's going to be a phenomenal deal. This is what the fans deserve, and I so want to give it to our guys.
And who will Jack Beckman race in round number two? It will be the winner of the next pair that's on the line right now, Jeff Arendt and John Force. And no matter how this championship goes down in Funny Car, certainly one of the great stories has got to be Todd Smith, the guy that's crewing this. Are you breathing a little easier now?
Yeah, a little bit easier now. You know, first round's always tough. It tries to get your nerves up, but we just tried to stay patient, and everybody was just resilient and pulled through. So we're looking forward to the next round.
Looking forward to it ourselves. Thank you.
And back at the line, there is John Force, who won the Winter Nationals right here at Pomona to start the season. He'll be going up against Jeff Arendt. Jeff is getting better and better. He qualified with a career best, 4.03 with a 6. Man, this could be good, too. Every pair that comes up, Mike.
Well, and the track conditions are getting good. We're seeing cars go down the racetrack much more often. Doesn't mean it's going to be perfect for everybody out there, but tell you what, I like the chances for Jeff Arendt right now. John Force got his work cut out for him.
And Jeff Arendt has got the win. 14 first-round losses for John Force there this year, the most ever.
Let's take a look at John Force. You see cylinders going out. It's already spinning the tires. That was, you just couldn't see the smoke underneath the body as it rolls up. It was still in the shake zone, just trying to come out of that point where you're applying the engine and the horsepower, and it just goes right up in tire smoke and ends John's weekend.
Well, Tuesday on ESPN, four championship coaches headline the State Farm Champions Classic from the Georgia Dome, the site of the Final Four. At 7, Tom Izzo's Michigan State Spartans take on Bill Self's Kansas Jayhawks. And then at 9, it's Coach K and the Duke Blue Devils as they take on John Calipari's national champion Kentucky Wildcats. Square off for the first time in 10 years. The State Farm Classic, Tuesday at 7 on ESPN. On the line now is Mike Neff, who is eliminated from the championship fight, and Paul Lee. And it's time for the Tequila Patron upset alert. Do you believe this one? Listen to Mike.
I picked it. Paul Lee over Mike Neff driving. Paul Lee driving for Gary Densham. And Gary only comes out once in a while, but he's been doing this since the 70s. And Paul Lee did a fantastic job in qualifying, a 4.03 lap time to actually out-qualify Mike Neff. Now Neff's totally out of the countdown for the championship after Ron Capps and Jack Beckman both won their races. Mike's going to try to concentrate on winning the race, but boy, he's got to get around a tough Paul Lee first.
Whoa!
Oh, they both spin.
Yeah. And once again, you lose, Mike. It's Mike Knapp, 4.22 with a 7.
What are you saying, Paul?
I'm just saying that you've been right much of the time.
Left side of your screen. What happened there is the car, when it launched for Paul Lee, it actually moved over towards the wall and then got out of the groove and started spinning the tires. You look at Mike Knapp, same situation, but it was farther down track. The car drove towards the center, got that right tire out of the groove, started spinning. Mike knew it was, if he stayed in, it was probably going to cross the center line. He got back in it. The car starts rotating around. That was kind of dangerous at that point, but he was still able to get the win.
Well, you tried, he tried, under the sun here in Southern California. When Top Fuel comes back to the line, Spencer Massey looking for a championship, as well as Tony Schumacher. So when they come out in the second round, it is a must-win for both. Back with the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series. The Auto Club of Southern California Finals. Robert Height and Johnny Gray at the line now, John Kernan.
Got some great news to report. Antron Brown has been released from the care center. And Antron, you know, what happened and, you know, what is the extent of your injuries?
No, just some little first-degree burns on the hands, you know, and it was a tough outing, you know. I mean, we were just going for it and doing what we normally do. And don't know what went wrong with the race car yet, but hey, man, Brian, Mark, all of our boys on our MACO team, an incredible job this year, man. Bad part is we got to wait and see what happens. We still have a very good chance for this thing. And, man, it was a rough mishap. And, hey, man, we just want to keep our heads high and thank God. Thank my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for just the opportunities he got. And he's kept all of us safe. And, hey, we'll keep marching on, man. We're still here, and there's going to be plenty more drag races and championships.
Well, you mentioned still have a shot at the championship depending upon what your teammates do in their upcoming elimination rounds. So what do you do?
Hey, I mean, we just sit here and watch. We sit here and wait, and we had a good points lead, and they got to go out and win the race, and that's a tough feat. But they got cars that are capable of doing it. So it's up in the air right now. So we just got to wait and watch. That's all we can do.
Thanks, Antron.
Well, Robert Height gets his first win in the countdown with a 4:52 over Johnny Gray.
Hey, you know, earlier in the rounds and field, we've been seeing tire smoke early in the runs. Now we're starting to see a little bit farther down track. You saw Johnny Gray spin the tires first, and then right after that was Robert Height. They both had to backpedal the cars to get the win because they weren't going to be able to coast across the finish and get the win. But you can see right there, just ever so short of the, oh boy, and then a little bit of a fire from Johnny Gray, but he's still legs with cylinders out, and finally he says, man, I drove far enough. Take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam. By over a car length, he's over a fireballing Johnny Gray.
So, with Funny Car first round now complete, here is the Lucas Oil ladder. Ron Capps will now face Robert Height. Will the 2009 Funny Car champion play spoiler? Height lost to Capps the last three times they've met this season.
It's all about the championship. Fast Jack Beckman's going to have lane choice over Jeff Arend, who also made a very good pass in the first round.
Now, with the Lincoln Tech Fix-It Pit Report, here's Dave Reed.
For Spencer Massey, it's all about shake, pedal, and win. His crew chief, Phil Schuler, said, boy, our driver sure did a great job to keep us in this championship chase now. But how do you fix a race car that was very unhappy early? Todd Okahara, the co-crew chief, told me, we were simply trying to not get outrun by Antron Brown and that Matco's team, something that's happened all too frequently this year. But as the sun shines down on this racetrack, it's going to get warmer. He says, we've got to go A to B now. We have to tune to the lane that we're going to be in, and that's going to be their approach when they take on Brandon Bernstein to see if they can stay alive in the championship chase in Top Fuel.
And while we still wait to see what's going to happen in the Nitro classes, we've already crowned two champions this weekend, Eddie Krawick in Pro Stock Motorcycle and Alan Johnson in Pro Stock. For Alan Johnson, his first ever win of a championship. Eddie, it was his third. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series concludes next weekend as Jimmy Johnson and Brad Keselowski battle for the championship. The NASCAR Sprint Car Series, the Ford 400 at Homestead, Miami, next Sunday at 2 o'clock on ESPN. Well, round one, Pro Stock. Jack Coughlin and Vincent Nobile. Vincent was fifth in the points last year. Look at that!
Perfect.
Unbelievable.
That's a second one of the season. Man, that is stout. He gets the win, a 6:58 at 211 miles per hour.
Ron Crisher in the Pontiac, also a Pontiac for Warren Johnson. Warren Johnson first raced at the finals in 1975. That race was held at Ontario Motor Speedway, but this one goes all to Ron Crisher with a 6:53. Shane Gray and history-making Erica Enders.
Shane, just like Warren, had trouble off the starting line. Erica Enders is going to waltz into the second round as she gets the win. A 6:51 at 212 miles per hour.
V. Gaines, who had a poor start to the season, but he's come on strong of late. And Jerry Ekman, first time that he's driven this century. He's in Steve Kent's car.
And V. Gaines gets the win all the way, 6:58 at 211 miles per hour.
Larry Morgan on the left in the Ford, the Chevrolet of Greg Anderson on the other side. Anderson will have his lowest points finish since 2001. He has been third or better ever since, and he takes the win with a 6:54.
Next up is Alan Johnson and Greg Stanfield. Greg Stanfield, one of the best drivers out there, gets the advantage off the starting line, but that's the only point he led as Alan Johnson goes down the track, both ends of the track record, 651.3, 212.7, 6 miles per hour.
Roger Brogdon, you're on board with him. This is his 100th race in Pro Stock Car. He's looking to win his 50th round of racing as he settles in with these technological wonders that are Pro Stock. It's Jason Lyne, number one qualifier in the other lane. Lyne lost first round at Dallas to Roger Brogdon, and that was on a hole shot.
Oh, 009 for Jason. That's going to be tough for Roger. Oh, and look at Jason. Ties the ET 651.3, but he sets the top speed track record at 213 miles per hour.
Mike Edwards in the Pontiac and Chris McGahey in the Dodge.
Chris McGahey outqualified Mike Edwards, and look at that, a good old drag race right there. Mike Edwards gets it. 653 beats a 654.
It's been a tough season for Mike Edwards, so looking ahead, here is the way the ladder breaks out. V Gaines and Erica Enders are going to face one another. Jason Lyne will have Vincent Nobile.
Other side of the ladder, your champion Alan Johnson is going to go up against Ron Crusher. Greg Anderson and Mike Edwards are going to match up. Mike will have lane choice.
These are the men that put the car together that gave Jack Beckman low lap time in round number one with a 403. That's why he continues to pack his chute as point leader as he prepares for round number two. And how about a special visitor? It's the legend, the Hall of Famer, Dale Armstrong. But as far as his crew chief, Todd Smith says, the run wasn't as pretty as it needs to be. He says, we simply need to wear more clutch. Not that we need to be quicker or faster, just more controllable. They race Jeff Arend.
And in Ron Capps' fit, they are getting ready for his next round matchup against Robert Height. One note on them, their clutch did not lock up like they thought it would in that last session. So in the tune-up, they were much softer than they thought for the track conditions. Well, Ron says that Height has a dangerous car. He says now is the time to have a savvy crew chief, and he believes he has one in Ron Tobler.
And tough fuel that is coming up. Antron Brown, despite losing first round, is still in play. He lost here a year ago and had to wait out the championship with a second round loss to Larry Dixon and didn't like it.
It just really hurts a little bit because, you know, you just want to bring it home for all the people that support you so much and for all these guys behind me and all that hard work throughout all the year besides on the last race, which is really cool. And we just wanted to have a chance to go duke it out, And we did, and we just fell short. So we did a great job at this race, and we just got to suck it up. And 2012's next year, the cool part is after the end of this race, all the points go back to zero, and we're going to get back after it. And I'm hungry right now, and I want to get back out there right now, but I got to wait the next year, but that's all right.
And today, Antron is waiting again. ESPN's presentation of the Automobile Club of Southern California Finals is brought to you by Fram. Fram filters help make sure failure is not a part of your engine's life. Don't fail your engine, use Fram. Welcome back to Pomona, California. The racing is so exciting, we sometimes forget how dangerous it can be. This is qualifying, and Todd Lysenko in his funny car.
And our ultra-mo shots are exciting. We couldn't have caught this a few years back, but this was absolutely amazing as the body blows completely off, but it stayed connected to the chassis at the rear of it, which lifted the rear tires completely off the ground and put the car 90 degrees to the finish line. As you watch Robert Height streak through there, Todd Lysenko, I thought, boy, this is going to be bad, but he was able to get the car turned around at this point. A couple of things happened that was very good in his favor. The headers, as you can see right there, scraping the ground, keeping the thing from tipping over. Also, the parachutes deploying. That also not only straightened the car up, but also scrubbed off some speed.
And the whole way, Todd Lysenko was conscious and still trying to drive that car, but he took a heavy hit to his helmet right there.
Just violent. 8,000 horsepower, and when it goes wrong, boy, does it go wrong.
The good news is that Todd Lysenko's okay, owing in part to the fine engineering that is done for safety on these cars. Look at that. Thank you. And this photograph taken by Mark Rabilis. Look at that. In the air, over the mountains, the body of Todd Lysenko's car. Well, it's time now for a Napa track fact. Here's Dave Reif.
To keep funny car bodies from coming apart from the chassis, they came up with a couple safety developments called burst panels. There's one on the engine, and there's one in the top of the body designed to keep these beautiful things, well, beautiful. Jim Dunn, your driver, Todd Lysenko, had it happen to him three times this year. It's a bit unprecedented. And are the three related at all?
Well, they're related because they're all mechanical, but different mechanical deals. One time I broke a rocker. The next time a spring coil bound and bent the valve. This time the hose got underneath the blower pulley and ripped in half, leaned the motor out, and it boomed.
Have you ever seen one like that that left the tree on the back of the car?
Yeah, most of them we have the tree until they tear off. That's why the back of the wheels are off the ground all the time.
Oh, that was some incredibly dramatic video.
Well, let's take a look now at where we stand in Top Fuel. Absolutely. After the first round. Spencer Massey and Antron Brown went side by side. Antron is on his way, hopefully, to a championship, but no, he loses to Spencer Massey. He's still in the championship fight, but Massey wins the first round. Now, Antron is only a spectator.
Then it's Tony Schumacher, the other driver in the countdown, with a chance at it alongside of J.R. Todd. J.R. gave him a great race, but it was Tony Schumacher with a 376 to get the win.
Recap of the first round of Top Fuel.
Tony Schumacher's crew hard at work turning the car around, getting ready for their second round matchup against Khalid Belushi. Tony says this is an absolute must win in his quest for the championship. He also says he's seen this movie before, just like he's seen Titanic 15 times. And you know what? Titanic always ends the same way. So Tony says today his job is to be the iceberg, do his job, win the race.
And for Antron Brown now, this is all he can do. Wait and watch and see what happens, because he is no longer in control of his own championship. Pro Stock Motorcycle in round one. Let's take a look at that. We begin with Chip Ellis and Steve Johnson. And the red light.
Ellis goes red, handing the win over to Steve Johnson. He's going to run that Suzuki to the finish line, see what he can get out of her. Oh, nice pass. A 686 and 195 to advance to the second round.
Steve's 26th race at the finals. Hector Arana on the Buell. First race to Pomona in 94. And Karen Stoffer on the Suzuki.
Hector Arana's had trouble launching that Buell all weekend, and the troubles continue. Karen Stoffer advances a 687 at 192 miles per hour.
The Suzuki of Ellie Tonglet and of Jimmy Underdahl. Underdahl has raced part-time this season. This is his fourth race here at Pomona.
Oh, this is a good old drag race. As Ellie gets the win on a hole shot, Underdahl runs a career best, but gets beat because Ellie left first. You'll take a look at the Lucas Oil photo finish cam by just a front wheel. Ellie advances.
Mike Berry draws Eddie Krawick, the new Pro Stock Motorcycle champion, a three-time champ.
Mike Berry had a huge advantage off the starting line, but it's not going to be enough. Look at that Harley just hugging the left side of that groove. 681, 198 miles per hour.
So for Eddie Krawick, let's meet his crew.
Hi, I'm Eddie Krawick, rider of Screaming Eagle Vance and Hines Harley-Davidson, and here's my crew guys.
I'm Matt Hines. I'm from California. I'm the crew chief.
Hi, I'm Ray Gritz from Lahaina, Colorado crew.
Hi, I'm Scott Skierman. I'm from California. I maintain the bikes and the engines.
Hi, I'm Andrew Hines, rider of the other Harley-Davidson D-Rug.
So now here is Eddie's teammate, Andrew Hines, and James Server. Server is on a Buell.
Server racing the number one qualifier. It's no match as Andrew Hines runs a nice 681 at 197 to advance to the second round.
John Hall and Hector Arana Jr. Hector is last year's rookie of the year and runner-up in the championship. Not won a race this season.
John Hall had problems as soon as he let the clutch out. Look at Jr. He advances to the second round with a 689.
Two Buells on the line. Scott Polacek and Sean Gann. Polacek qualified a career best run, made the top 10 in his first full season ever.
This guy's had a good motorcycle, and boy, it continues. A 687 to 191 advances him.
is Matt Smith and Angie Smith, his wife. She's trying to get that motorcycle set to go. Wow, she's into it.
She'll do whatever it takes.
So Matt Smith on the Buell faces another Buell in the hands of Michael Ray.
Michael Ray got the advantage by 0.03 of a second, but Matt Smith's been running well as he gets the win in a good race. Great time, a 682 at almost 196 miles per hour.
So the Pro Stock motorcycle Lucas Oil Ladder looks this way going to the second round. Andrew Hines has Steve Johnson, Matt Smith, and Hector Arana Jr.
Other side of the ladder, your champion Eddie Krawick will run Karen Stopher, and Scotty Polacek will have lane choice over Ellie Tonglet.
Tuesday on ESPN, Ford Championship coaches headline the State Farm Champions Classic. At 7, Tom Izzo's Michigan State Spartans take on Bill Self's Kansas Jayhawks. And then at 9, Coach K's Duke Blue Devils square off against John Calipari's national champion Kentucky Wildcats for the first time in 10 years. It's all Tuesday on ESPN at 7. Well, as we go into the second round of Top Fuel, Spencer Massey continues to fight for a championship. This time he will face Brandon Bernstein. The ladder for Top Fuel, the Lucas Oil ladder, as we go into this second round, looks this way with Tony Schumacher and Khalid Baluchi going to face one another. A classic matchup. This is Clay Milliken and Mike Salinas. Both guys come through as upsets in the first round, and we got a let's see where it's gone. Milliken, come on.
Keep it off the wall, keep it off the slide, but you got it.
Wow. We have seen so much today, and what a run that was. Salinas, you saw the parachutes drop, and then I thought for a moment that Clay was into the wall.
Well, and here's the thing. The parachutes dropped because it backfired the supercharger right there for Mike Salinas. Now, Clay Milliken, he doesn't know this. His job, I have to get it to the finish line as best I can under power. He's trying to get that thing to recover, but the other thing you have to do is you have to keep it off the wall, and you have to keep it from crossing the center line. Clay Milliken got it rotated around really pretty good there. We saw that thing, it made them move to the wall, he straightened it up and down the track. One more look, right there, right here, it's gonna drift, and then boom, got her straight, gets the win. Take a look at the launch. Both cars, instant tire smoke, just rolled right up on it. Mike Salinas, though, he backfired the supercharger. He was dead in the water. And then Clay Milliken's doing everything he can to get the win, and he was able to do it.
Well, the fight for the Top Fuel Championship continues on. Spencer Massey and Tony Schumacher. They are both the challengers against Antron Brown. But in order to do that, they have to win this round.
So how will you know the ending to this deal?
Welcome back to the finals at Pomona, the Auto Club of Southern California finals. And on the right, that's Bob Fry, who is retiring as the chief announcer of the PA system.
I'll tell you something, Paul, we're going to miss him here in NHRA. Everybody loves Bob Fry. You see Tim Wilkerson's race car. He started out announcing at ACCO Raceway. He provides me with the data that I use to do my stats. We will miss him on tour.
Coverage of Monday Night Football continues on ESPN. First at 6:30, it's Monday Night Countdown, presented by Applebee's. Then at 8:30, it's the comeback season as the Chiefs face off against Pittsburgh. Monday, 8:30 on ESPN. Bob Vandergrift and Corey McLennathan up to the line now. Brandon Bernstein and Spencer Massey are coming up.
That's going to be a monster matchup, but right now we're all eyes are on track conditions. The first pair of cars going down the track, too much wheel speed, spun the tires at the head of the throttle. 90-degree track temperatures, that's normally very manageable, but we've seen a lot of these teams missing it today.
Vandergrift has won this year. Corey has not been to a semifinal. Vandergrift has that one at 383, 323 miles an hour. They are on their game. There's no question about that. Back at the start line, Antron Brown. All he can be is a spectator now. He still has a great chance to be the champion at the end of the day. You remember his fire in the first round of eliminations. You see the bandages on his hands. They're first-degree burns of the palms of the hand. Well, we talked about Spencer Massey. He is the next pair coming out. Spencer Massey and Brandon Bernstein, and you get a hint of it there, is Tony Schumacher, who will face Khalid Baluchi. Wow, what a lineup this has become, and what an event it has become. So many upsets. Here are the points as they are right now, and it's really simple. Both Tony Schumacher or Spencer Massey have to win if they want to win. They have to win the race. Well, wow. How'd you like to be in Antron, too?
Well, yeah, as a driver, you hate it. You like to be in control of your own destiny. Now he has to sit that back and just hope something happens for him to get the championship. But right now, Spencer Massey, he's really got a tough matchup with Brandon Bernstein. Brandon has definitely had a better car up to this point than Spencer Massey. He's outran him. We've made four runs down the racetrack. We had one session rained out. Three out of four times, Brandon Bernstein has ran better than Spencer Massey, including that great first round win when he ran that 377 over Terry McMillan. So this is going to be tough for Spencer right now.
And if you remember earlier, we heard from Phil Shuler that team, the Fram team, tried to rotate the earth, and they say they're going to try to tune this car to the lane now. You have to be very, very delicate now on a 90-degree racetrack. We've seen some of the cars having problems already. As far as that left lane goes, Todd O'Kahari said, we think there's a 380 in it. If Bernstein runs faster than that, so be it.
Well, we saw a 383 from Bob Vandergrift. That was in the right lane. Now, Corey was actually ahead of Bob up to the middle of the racetrack and then started spinning the tires way down track. So track conditions are there, but like I said, you got to kind of be careful because it is a second round, a little more sun on the track.
Spencer's got to be thinking. Last year, he lost the championship by 4 thousandths of a second. And, whoa, did he? No, he did not dodge the bullet. Wow, Brandon Bernstein, a 380, 323 miles an hour, and Spencer Massey is out of play. Wow. Unexpected, huh?
We've been seeing this a lot out of the Schumacher dragsters. Burnt head gasket on the other end. Spencer Massey was ahead by 0.02 of a second to the eighth mile, but then you saw it pushing out the head gasket, pushing that fire out. Now, what that does is it takes away cylinder pressure, robs horsepower. Now, still under power, still able to go to the finish line. I mean, he went a 384, but he was slowing to only 282 miles per hour. Had that thing not pushed those head gaskets out, he would have got that round win, but... You know, if.
So Spencer Massey has been eliminated from the possibility of taking the championship. Dave Reif.
Well, Don Schumacher obviously still waiting to see what the eventual outcome of this is going to be, but having to say goodbye to Fram, a longtime sponsor, this is a tough moment.
Oh, it's a very tough moment, but we're going to go on with that team. It's going to be together, and we'll go forward from there next year. It's a shame that Fram Prestone has left the sport, but hopefully they'll see what's going on out here and come on back.
Do I have to ask if you're still rooting for your son?
No, you don't have to ask that.
Let's take you back, Mike, just 1 year ago, and this was when Spencer Massey had his shot at it in the semifinals.
Against Dell Worsham, this was for the championship. Dell Worsham got the win by 0.04 of a second, won the championship. What a great drag race.
And that's just exactly the kind of day we seem to be having today. Spencer Massey rolls to a stop up at the top end, and we go to Dave Reif.
Now, Antron, one of your combatants is out of this field. Are you breathing any easier yet?
I don't know. I got to watch this round right now, man. We're not counting anything yet or doing anything. We got to watch this round. Let's know how I feel, Dave.
So Antron watches on from the starting line. Here is Tony Schumacher. This is a classic matchup. Tony Schumacher, and he's going to face actually the product of his previous team, which is now Elanabi Racing and Khalid Baluchi. Well, Tony Schumacher's team has a winning record, 17-15, against Alan Johnson's Elanabi team. And once again, when you ask the crew, what do they have that's special, their answer is 201. We have Tony Schumacher. We're going to win it.
Well, there's no lack of confidence for Tony Schumacher, nor that man. Alan Johnson knows how to run these race cars. Obviously, with his resume, he's won a lot of championships and won a lot for Tony Schumacher. But, you know, it was a surprise. A lot of people felt that when Alan Johnson left to form the Elanabi team, that this team would not be anywhere close to where it was. Well, guess what? They went out and won the championship the first year without Alan, and they've been in the hunt every year since then, including this year.
Guy's just amazing. Calls himself a machine. He's dead right. Antron Brown has to watch. Don't count out Belluccio. The car is good, and he got his first Top Fuel win at Maple Grove this year. And the way things have gone today, anything can happen. Schumacher, this again is a must win. Antron could take the championship right here. This guy's absolutely amazing. Marching toward a championship with a 376, 325 miles an hour. And so the agony for Antron goes on. Stat guy.
So just think about this one. Once again, Tony Schumacher will take on Bob Vandegrift here at the Fairplex for a chance to go on to win a championship. But remember, 2 weeks ago, Bob Vandegrift took him out in the final round at Vegas, and Vandegrift loved that moment.
Well, Antron, you said wait till after this run, so tell me, how are you feeling now?
I mean, like I said, I mean, Tony's still in it. They got a chance, and I mean, it's nothing to get excited about until it's over. So we're just going to watch each and every round and see where we end up at. Just the worst feeling still on the outside looking in, but that's what's in the car, so it's got to keep rolling.
Nothing to get excited about, nothing to be depressed about yet.
Well, last year, almost in this same spot, 0.004 of a second, decided your championship fate. This time it happens a round or so earlier, and I'm sure it's a very, very bitter pill to have to swallow.
Yeah, by far. It's we really wanted to win. I mean, for a number of reasons. Obviously, we came that close last year, and we wanted to win this championship for Fram, for Prestone. I mean, we just want to win, and we had to get by Brandon just then, and it's one of those deals. I'm pretty sure we were out ahead, then it looked like I pushed a head gasket out, and then it just laid over, and then right before the finish line, I saw Brandon go by. It's one of those things. Now it's up to Tony. If Tony can get a couple more round wins, he can be the champ again. So Antron or Tony, DSR, hey, what did I say? We're going to be third, so 1, 2, and 3 is always a good thing.
Let's check in with Tony Schumacher now as he's congratulated by Caleb Belushi. Sarge, another one down, only two to go, and another championship looms out there. How confident are you feeling at this point based on what you've been able to accomplish in these first two rounds?
I love this moment. I live for it. You know, I mean, the fans know it. Our team knows it. The Army knows it. And Tom Tiernan, I gave him this before the run, and he never asked me to carry stuff, but he's retiring, and he was the man that put this Army team together at the beginning. And it was great to carry it. You know, I believe in Jesus, man, and I think that this is a big, big, big moment, and I couldn't do it alone. So I appreciate the help. The Army soldiers on Veterans Day, beautiful day, man. Beautiful day to win a race, beautiful day to become a champion. But if I can't, Antron Brown will make it a wonderful champion, and I look forward to it.
Thanks.
Nasty quick car. Cruz Pedregon tied the track record ET in the third session of qualifying, and Mike Neff. Neff is out of contention for the championship. Second round of funny car with a hole shot. A 408, 298 mile an hour pass for Cruz Pedregon. I'll tell you what, this car, this guy have been amazing this year. Surprised they don't have a better record. Well, coming up is that battle in funny car. Jack Beckman, who is the points leader. He's looked strong today. The cars look good. But then he faces Ron Capps, who is looking for his very first win, as is Jack, first championship win. And that's coming up.
You got a choice to make. So what's it gonna be? So what's it gonna be? You got a choice to make. If you really want it, you can go.
An American soldier, an American.
Hi, this is Jeff Gordon. I want to say thank you to all the veterans for all that they've done and the commitment that they've given to our freedom and our peace in this country and all that they continue to do.
And along with Jeff, we offer a special thanks to the thousands of National Guard troops who are helping our friends on the East Coast secure their homes and dig out from the debris of Hurricane Sandy. Well, look how close they're getting, just two pairs away, and it'll be Ron Capps up to the line in this ongoing battle for the Funny Car Championship. And Mike, I'm tense with this thing.
Yeah, it's pretty exciting, and I guarantee you the drivers are tense. Once they fire those engines up, though, they better not be. They better be focused. Courtney Force right now, she's been pretty focused all season long. See Ron Capps and that NAP team getting ready for their matchup. But right now, Courtney Force up against Tim Wilkerson. Courtney does have the lane, so she made that great 405 pass. Tim Wilkerson had that pedal fest and was able to just drive around Jim Head in a good race. It wasn't big numbers, but it was exciting.
For Courtney Force. In the finals, he's still in play. 406, 317 miles an hour over Tim Wilkerson, who fades right at the start. So one John Force racing car is moving on. Maybe another will in just a moment.
And if you ever wonder how they pick which order they go in eliminations, it always goes to the first option, to the car with the lower laps time. That, of course, was Jack Beckman. And I just talked to Todd Smith and said, you decided to go last. How come? He said two reasons. One, you can see what happens out in front of you in case they need to make any last-minute adjustments. Plus, by going last, they'll know what they have to do because Ron Capps is in the pair right in front of them.
Well, there is Jack Beckman. Ron Capps trails Beckman by 2 points. He must advance one round farther than Beckman to win the championship. Ron Capps and the John Force racing car of Robert Hight. Look at this, career, the two, 21-12, Hight over Ron Capps.
What are you trying to say there, Paul?
I'm thinking Robert's got something going, and he's got Jimmy Prock as well. This could be a bad moment for Capps.
Well, it could be, but I think Ron has a more consistent race car. I mean, Robert Hight still and Jimmy Prock still battling the consistency in that clutch department. Ron Tolbert seems to have a handle on this car after struggling early in qualifying, but, you know, anything can happen. And remember, Ron Capps has to win this round. If he loses to Robert Hight, Jack Beckman is your champion.
Hey, look at that. 2 points. We come this whole season, and 2 points separates the top two contenders. Jack Beckman and Jeff Arend, they're getting ready to come out. But the key is Ron Capps. This is a must win. He doesn't, Jack Beckman is the champion. Ron Capps wins, and he'll face Courtney Ford in the next round. Jack Beckman in his car again, trying to calm down. And it goes on. It continues on. Ron Capps, 407, 315 miles an hour. Ron Capps is still in the game against Jack Beckman.
Another look. Ron Capps had the advantage off the starting line. Robert Hight, like we've seen all through the countdown, struggled getting down the racetrack. Capps just goes from A to B, a 407, to get the win.
Yeah, a little happiness there as well.
And a big sigh of relief, too.
Yeah, you can bet. So this championship battle is still in the game. Now, at the moment, Ron Capps has the points lead by 18. But Jack Beckman has yet to get into play in this round.
So even though Jeff Arend isn't Ron Capps' teammate, I bet he's his best friend right now.
Yeah.
Not that he doesn't like Jack, but Ron Capps wants to win the championship.
Hey, buddy, how you doing? Need a little dinner, a little extra money? I'm your guy. And you know what? Jeff Arend has been very good recently.
Yeah, this is no easy race right here. I mean, Jeff has been running well. Qualified number six with a 403.
That was his career best right there.
Yeah, and he went 408 in the first round. Fast Jack went 403. Now, Todd Smith and the team, they like that left-hand lane. A lot of the teams have been picking the right-hand lane with lane choice. But you can't argue with him. He took the left-hand lane in the first round when a lot of people were choosing the right. And what does he do? Runs low ET of the round, 403.
13-4, Jack Beckman over Jeff Arend.
the one thing I also like about taking the left-hand lane, Jeff Wren had lane choice, and he was the only other 20-car driver that took the left-hand lane and ran that number. So they're off, not only are they taking the lane they like, talking about Todd Smith and Jack Beckman, but I think they're putting Jeff Wren in a lane that they probably would less prefer.
Miles an hour. Jeff Wren gave him a good run, but this car continues to be stout with one dedicated driver in Jack Beckman. So it'll move on to the semifinals, and the matchups will be Ron Capps against Courtney Force. Courtney will have the lane choice.
Another matchup, Cruz Pedregon's going to go up against Jack Beckman, and by virtue of that great 402, Jack will have lane choice.
If I offered you an antacid right now, would you accept?
Only if it's one of our sponsors, Gary. Oh, man. I guess we should expect this. It's been that kind of a year, and I'm so proud of the Valvoline team. These guys are, they're my family, and I'm happy for Schumacher. Jack, I don't know about. No, we have a good time. We're good friends, and it's gonna be one of those deals. You can't look forward to racing him later. We got Courtney Force next, and she's got a good hot rod, a pretty good last name. It does well at this track, so you can't overlook that. But my Napa guys, man, we'll put our Oakleys on and jump back in that Charger and see what we can do.
Let's get a word with here with Jack. How gut-wrenching is this, Mr. Jack?
Well, I was just making sure my hair looked okay. Wow. If they gave me the choice, I would want to run before the other car, because sitting back there watching them sucks. Hard on the heart. We're stepping up. Both teams are rising to the occasion. This is what the fans deserve. Hey, we're losing two legends after this weekend. Paul Page and Bob Fryer stepping away. Two guys that have done a tremendous amount for our sport, and I want to thank them for all their hard work here. Happy Veterans Day. This veteran wants two more round wins.
Thank you.
Nice of Jack. Very nice. Gotcha. Well, how about the Top Fuel game? Tony Schumacher, if he can keep going rounds and he can win the race, then Tony Schumacher will take the championship away from Antoine Brown, who is only a spectator now. You like the speed, you like the power. Oh, check this out. Just a little taste of what's been going on this weekend. Kind of cool, Mike, if they couldn't all run that way, just back to back to back. That'd be cool.
Man, they go fast.
They do. You should know that. The Auto Club of Southern California Finals, part of the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series, and Ron Capp's car is already back. They're going to work on it right now, get it ready for the next round. And here is the Lucas Oil Pro Stock Ladder with Alan Johnson going to face Ron Crisher. Alan Johnson, of course, the champion, but still wants to make an impression here today. Right now, on the line, it's Greg Anderson and Mike Edwards. Anderson had nearly a perfect run on Friday to go number one. Eventually taken away by his teammate, Jason Lund.
Oh, and he goes red.
Not going anywhere. So Greg Anderson with the red light. He did not get past the second round at any countdown race. Mike Edwards has the win. Well, it's time now for our Prestone Ask the Expert. And for John Force, Dale H. Layton is asking, any plans on retiring and taking it easy for a change? John has the answer.
Dale, just to answer your question, bottom line, drag racing is the only thing I know, NHRA drag racing. Retirement is not an option for me, and I'll tell you why. I've got a race car that runs over 300 miles an hour in 4 seconds, and it doesn't know how old I am. So let me make it clear. This is my life. It's where I live. And I thrive on winning. I thrive on organization and reorganization. And that's what I'm doing right now. And I'll be back in that seat. I'll be back in that winner's circle. You can count on that when the end comes is when I fall on the playing field right here at an NHRA race. It's the way it is.
Classic John Forrest. Here's Pete Gaines and Erica Enders, and Gaines turns on the red light. So Enders, who's had a historic year, becoming the first woman ever to win in pro stock, is going to continue on into the semifinals.
Back in Tony Schumacher's pit is U.S. Army crew hard at work turning the car around, getting ready for that next matchup against Bob Vandegrift, a repeat of the final at Vegas 2 weeks ago. And Tony told me, you know, if we had beaten Vandegrift at Vegas 2 weeks ago and not be as big a matchup as the one that is coming up in the semifinals here today at Pomona. Tony has been saying if you want to win the championship, you should have to go out and win the last race of the season.
Well, coming up is our new Pro Stock champion. That is Alan Johnson. Wins it after 17 years of trying. He's up against Ron Prischer. He's not had that much good this year, only been in the semis twice in 2012. Can he do it here?
Ron Prischer has a good car this weekend, but Alan Johnson's got a great car, so it's going to be tough for Ron to get around him.
In right lane, we've seen a couple of red lights. See one on the left, too. Not this time. So now can Ron Prischer take down the new champion? Not a chance. 652, 212 miles an hour to a losing 653.
Well, for Ron Tobler, that's Ron Capp's crew chief. The winning time slip told him everything he needed to know. It was a run for more and more cuts. And I asked him, I said, I've got plenty of tires left for the rest of the day. He just smiled. Oh, yeah.
Fourth and final pair in the second round of Pro Stock Eliminations in line. Vincent Nobile about to attack the track. Meanwhile, top end.
This poor dodge of your crew is jinkum enough. You know, I'm just the dummy behind the wheel here, and they're giving me a great car and makes you confidence, makes you drive good. So, you know, thank you to them. Thank you to the Lord. And it's just, it's a great deal.
Trying to put a little cherry on here today.
Perfect luck first round. Jason Lyon is the number one qualifier.
Double 00 first round, double 02 second round. Oh, and he wins on a huge hole shot.
Jason Lyon just set the track record and lost.
By a bunch. Oh. 15 thou at the finish. A 6:54 beats a 6:49, and it wasn't even close. That kid is top.
Rates, wife of the car owner, Nick Mitzos, for lane choice when they go into the semifinals. And Alan Johnson take on Mike Edwards. Alan, he's got the lane choice. Now, can you imagine what's going on? Palms of his hand are first degree, a few blisters, but he's okay. His real problem is he's got to be clean.
This is why Anton is nervous, because here comes Tony Schumacher. He's done it. So if it was anybody else, he probably wouldn't be as nervous. But when it's Tony Schumacher, and he's done it so many times before, watch out.
Tony Schumacher has a way of winning from behind. In the battle for a Top Fuel championship that is so close, you have to be perfect. But many times it's the little things that go wrong that cost the championship. And that is the topic of today's Traxxas Extreme Power Session.
And we're going to focus on Antoine Brown at the last race in Las Vegas. First round matchup against Caleb Belushi. He lost that round, and he explained what happened.
I wish I could just did a little bit better job. I stuck with it too long, and then when I stuck with it too long, because I saw the finish line here, I was letting the car spin the tires. I should have blapped the throttle again, and maybe we could have got that win off there.
Well, what happened was the command module failed, and normally it would start applying the clutch at 1.1 seconds. It didn't, and at 1.9 seconds, he would normally feel 5 G's of acceleration. Instead, Antron felt less than 3, and the engine RPM was 700 RPM higher, the same thing he would have felt if it was spinning the tires. Hindsight being 20/20, if he had not pedaled, he probably would have won the round. Drivers have only a split second to make a decision, and when you add the pressure running for the championship and it doesn't go right, it can be devastating.
And if Antron would have won that race, he would have won the championship. It's the little things. Pro Stock Motorcycle, their second round. Here is the Lucas Oil Ladder with Eddie Krawick and Karen Stoffer going to face one another. Karen Stoffer, of course, on that Suzuki. No Suzuki has won this year.
On the line right now, you got Scotty Polacek up against Ellie Tonglen. Polacek really seems to be getting that bike turned around. George Bryce calling the shots on that, making some good runs. Scotty had the advantage by 0.02 seconds off the starting line. Race.
Can he carry it against Ellie? No, he cannot. 689, 195 miles an hour to a losing 691.
Back in the pits, Antoine Brown sitting around with his crew as they wait for to watch the next round of eliminations to see if Tony Schumacher continues his charge toward another championship. And Antoine says what's really hurts about not being in control of your own destiny is that it was caused by a broken fuel line, a parts failure. Said it would have been a little bit easier to deal with if the team or himself had done something wrong. But they're just sitting here playing the waiting game.
And Mike has said that time and time again. Antron used to race these Pro Stock Motorcycle. Here's Hector Arana Jr. and Matt Smith.
Take a look at Hector Arana Jr. He ran that 689 in the first round, but Matt Smith has really been coming around on that Buell. Been making some great passes, including that 682 in the first round. I mean, he's running right there with the Harleys right now.
That's saying something. Red light, though. Hector turns on the red light. Matt Smith goes on to the win. So Matt Smith will go into the semifinals. 684 is the number. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series concludes next weekend as Jimmy Johnson and Brad Keselowski, well, they battle for the championship. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series, the Ford 400, that's at Homestead, Miami, next Sunday at 2 o'clock on ESPN. Eddie Krawick, new champion, and Karen Stoffer. They're going to change the whole formula for Pro Stock Motorcycle for next year, and we'll see how that shakes up the field. But it's been the Harley field this year.
Oh, Karen goes rad.
Well, she knew she had to push it hard. She pushed it too hard. Eddie Krawick, 681, 198 miles an hour, has the win.
Well, it's Cruz Pedregon that steps in the way of Jack Beckman becoming a champion next for him. And as far as the crew chief goes, Todd Smith said he wanted to wear more clutch, and the car did exactly what he wanted it to do. It made the run smoother, and it allowed him to pick up a few hundredths of a second in the ET department. But remember at the top of the show, I talked about blow-ups, car switches, and even cancer. Jack Beckman can overcome everything. That he is feeling right now. Jack Beckman is still enjoying this championship Sunday in California.
The last pair in Pro Stock Motorcycle is Andrew Hines, three-time Pro Stock Motorcycle champion, but never in the countdown era, and Steve Johnson, who's having the best day of this season. Two U.S. Nationals winners go to one another. How about a track record for Andrew Hines? A 678 with an 897-mile-an-hour pass. Well, they're going to show what they have in this final race of the season. So when Pro Stock Motorcycle comes back for the semifinals, here is the way it's going to look. Andrew Hines will have lane choice as he faces Matt Smith. What a great day for Matt so far, though.
Yes, it is. And then Andrew's teammate, Eddie Krawick, your champion, is going to go up against former champion Ellie Tonglen, and Eddie will have lane choice in that matchup.
Well, is he going to do it again? Big giant come from behind to win the championship. I'll tell you what. And look how calm he looks, Mike. Tony Schumacher, who still has a shot at the Top Fuel Championship.
It's the countdown to the championship, and every run can make or break your title hopes. Can you say pressure? NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing, only on ESPN.
Back back at Pomona, California, the Auto Club of Southern California Finals, the NHRA Full Throttle Drag Racing Series, Top Fuel, the semifinals. Clay Milliken and Brandon Bernstein at the line. Here is the ladder, and the championship is still in play if Tony Schumacher can go on and win this race. And watching, an interested spectator went out the first round, Antron Brown. He, too, can still win, depending on the outcome of the race overall.
It all depends on what Tony Schumacher does. If you look at him, second pair out, get ready for his matchup with Bob Vandegrift. Right now, Brandon Bernstein and Clay Milliken on the line. Brandon Bernstein has been running well. Clay Milliken, he's been lucky. Hasn't ran well, good all day long. But hopefully, he's hoping he can step up right now and get around Brandon.
Brandon's 11-5 over Clay. And it's going further yet. Brandon Bernstein is on into the
nice
final.
Run too.
Yeah, that's sweet. 379 and 322 miles an hour. So here's the other half of the semifinal, and it is Tony Schumacher. He's closest to you. He is now just two win lights away from his eighth championship. And this is what he's done in the finals before. And comes from behind and points down.
Let's call him the comeback kid.
And if he does it this day, absolutely. On the other hand, in the other lane is Bob Vandegrift, who upset Tony in the final round 2 weeks ago at Las Vegas to win his second career race. So this is an incredible matchup any way you look at it. Vandegrift, you know, is going to do everything he can to take Tony Schumacher out of competition and give the championship over to Antron Brown. But then so much of this is luck.
Talking with Tony Schumacher's crew chief Mike Green, he says, hey, we are not changing a thing for this run right here. All the data from today has looked pretty good. Says the track should cool off a little bit, tighten up just a little bit, but still making no changes at all. In fact, they didn't even change engines like a lot of teams do after second round.
And if winning weren't enough motivation for Bob Vandegrift, who beat Tony Schumacher in our last race in Las Vegas, there was a little episode at the top end of the racetrack yesterday when the two went side by side in qualifying. Bob felt like Tony held him out a little bit at the starting line and had no problems letting the Sarge know about it at the top end. You can best believe Bob Vandegrift would like to end Tony Schumacher's championship run right here.
Well, and this also could go back to 2007. As you look at the sun in Tony Schumacher's eyes, it's also in Bob Vandegrift's eyes, maybe even more so in that left-hand lane. Tony's been here before. He knows how to adjust. Bob Vandegrift, now back in 2007, Bob was able to take out Hot Rod Ford in the first round, and then he got beat in the final by Tony Schumacher. So the bad blood, I wouldn't say bad blood, but the animosity maybe go back a little bit longer than even the qualifying sessions we had here where they did get into it a little bit.
Antron Brown, the spectator. He can be the champion. Let's see what happens with Schumacher. That's close.
Oh,
Schumacher,
man.
A 381 to a losing 384. And Schumacher is now one step closer.
Wow. 33 ten-thousandths of a second at the finish line.
Now just one win light to go for Tony Schumacher, and he has a championship.
Bob Vandegrift had the advantage off the starting line by over 0.02 of a second. As you look at Tony Schumacher exploding just as he gets to the finish line, 33 ten-thousandths of a second, the margin of victory.
Well, Mike Green making his way back to the pits right now. 33 ten-thousandths a second, the margin of victory. But what was going through your mind when you saw that flash?
Yeah, I don't know if it started spinning down there or what happened, but I knew if our car made a good full run, we'd probably win. But, you know, Tony did a great job hanging with it and keeping it. It looked like it started moving around. So I don't know if it was something in the engine or started spinning the tires or what, but we'll go back and look at it and get ready for Brandon.
You've earned the opportunity to run for the championship.
Right there, you see what spin the tires. It looked like a cylinder went out, and then it backfired the supercharger. See the cylinders out right there, big time.
Wow.
And then it just backfires the supercharger, but just at the right time for Tony, because if it had been any sooner than that, he might have lost that round.
Yeah, just a few feet short, maybe a car length from the finish line. Tail of the tape.
Take a look at that, 33 ten-thousandths, 18 inches at the stripe.
Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Tony Schumacher looking at just how close it was there. So the table has been set. You've been down this street before. Your emotions now as you start thinking about the possibility of what's at stake in the next and final round.
Well, I don't know, man. I showed up in Vegas 130 or 40 or 50 points out of the lead, and Antron had to win one round, and I really hadn't thought about writing a speech, but, you know, huge round coming up. Bernstein's been kind of tough on me, and we just got to do what we got to do. It's Veterans Day. What a beautiful opportunity for my father. I win the race, we're the champ. If I lose a race, Antron's the champ. I mean, what could any father or team owner ask for more than that? It's a beautiful opportunity. You know, Antron's got Army on the side of the car too, and his father was a soldier. But, you know, for my Uncle Frank, who was a Vietnam veteran, and for all the veterans of all the wars that have sacrificed so much, we're giving you the chance, man. We're doing our best. Hated to blow the blower off it, man. That car was really performing well, but we'll go fix it.
All right, Stat Guy.
Well, think about this one, a classic matchup, the Schumachers against the Bernsteins, but I go back to 2007, the semifinals, if Brandon Bernstein takes out Tony Schumacher, he would have been the champion, and he came up short that year.
If I wrote this up,
the finals matchup then in Top Fuel goes this way. Tony Schumacher and Brandon Bernstein. Schumacher looking for a championship with a win in the final. And Brandon Bernstein, it's been a long, long time since he has had a win. So it is the Funny Car semifinal. Courtney Force and Ron Capps. Well, this is it again as we take a look at the ladder coming into this semifinal. You've got Ron and Courtney, and then Cruz Pedregon and Jack Beckman. Now, Ron Capps needs to win the round to stay in contention. If Capps loses, then Jack Beckman is the champ. So Capps needs to keep pace. Let's look at the points. They are, oh, so close in Funny Car. Close? Two. 2 points. We're coming to the end of the season. Jack Beckman, they get ready with his machine. He'll be in the next pair. He faces Cruz Pedregon.
Let's take a look at Ron Capps' record against Courtney Force, because this is a good matchup. 5-1 over Courtney, but it's not going to be easy. Courtney has a very good race car. Lane choice, he's taken right. Doesn't matter. Jack Beckman, Todd Smith, Terry Snyder, the crew chief, they like that left-hand lane. They ran low ET of eliminations, of each round of elimination in that left-hand lane. So there are no excuses. The previous race in Vegas, remember, Courtney redlined against Jack Beckman when Jack smoked the tires. It was there for the taking, and she couldn't deliver.
Courtney Force, as Jack Beckman looks on, is the last John Force Racing car standing. This is Ron Capps' moment.
Oh, again, an incredibly close race, and it is Courtney Force.
Wow.
4:06, and Ron Capps has lost in the semifinals, and Jack Beckman, that man right there, is now, for the first time in his career, the Funny Car champion.
What a day this has been thus far. A lot of smiles down there in the Beckman camp, though. Tommy Johnson Jr. with his congratulations. How close was it? Look at this, Mike.
About half a car length. Ron had the advantage off the starting line, but Courtney had the advantage on the racetrack.
You come all this way, and you lose a championship by half a car length. Ron Capps. Fourth time in his long career that he is the bridesmaid in the championship. Taking their time with Jack. Cruz Pedregon's already burned out. And
And there is Jack Beckman as Ron Capps up at the top end. And when Ron Capps lost, this was Jack Beckman's reaction. It's like, okay, okay, but we still have plenty to do here.
Well, he understands that. I mean, he wants to go out there and win the race and stay focused, because a lot of times that pressure comes off, you lose focus, and you end up losing the race. Now, I mean, obviously the championship is the important equation, part of the equation, but, you know, you don't want to give away those race wins either. And I tell you what, I mean, it's, you know, I hate to say it's kind of karma, because remember, they did the switch back in April. Ron Capps basically went into Jack Beckman's car with the crew and everything, and then Jack went over there and his... basically had a makeshift crew come over. Todd Smith came in. Terry Snyder was already there. They struggled initially, but boy, did they put together. And I'll tell you what, it's a well-deserved job by that team.
Weird thing, swap of the crew. Jack Beckman, how hard do they go now?
Well, I mean, you know, there's still a possibility of an oil down penalty. He would get penalized 10 points if he did oil down in the track, so that might... You know, but, you know, right, you're going to go for it. You're going to go for the win. I mean, they're confident in that race car, and unless they have a mechanical problem, it should go down the track. But they got to get around Cruz. Look at that.
Which
Cruiser.
Is going to be a tall order.
Wow, Cruz, look at that.
402 at 314 miles an hour. Jack Beckman loses in the semifinals.
So Ron Capps, by less than 0.02 of a second, loses the championship to Jack Beckman.
So it's over in funny car. We've said it before, Jack Beckman now has his first ever championship. Dave Reif.
Well, what is quickly going to become the story of the year? Jack Beckman
with Ron Capps.
And a crew chief that's used to doing top fuel. What's this moment feel like, Todd?
You know, it's a lifetime of trying, hard work and perseverance. You know, it all comes down to this. You know, what a crazy day where it could have just gone either direction. But, you know, it's a dream come true. It's like they always say, you work so hard your whole life and you finally get there. And I got to tell you, it just feels great.
I wonder how many times you're going to have to pinch yourself tonight. Congratulations to you and Terry Snyder as well.
Well, the final check, there is no oil down, so Jack Beckman, that was the only thing that could have messed this up. Jack Beckman is the champ. What a great guy he is, too. He's so eloquent when he gives interviews. Such a good racer, good instructor. He waited a long time for this moment. Five races into the 2012 season, Jack Beckman's world was turned upside down, or so it seemed. Team owner Don Schumacher took Beckman's more experienced crew and swapped it with Ron Capps' team. Led by crew chief Todd Smith, Beckman and his new team quickly gelled. They captured two wins in the regular season, then one more in the countdown. And now, for the first time in his career, Fast Jack Beckman has earned the title of NHRA Funny Car Champion.
Wow. The drama of this amazing season finally playing out in terms of funny car, and Tom Compton, the president of NHRA, ready to make a presentation to Jack Beckman for his first Nitro Championship.
Well, Jack, you've overcome a lot of battles in your life, and you've won another battle here today. Congratulations on being the NHRA Full Throttle Funny Car World Champion.
Could you say that again, please, Tom?
Jack, as those words slowly begin to sink in, and after the emotions of this amazing head-to-head battle with your teammate Ron Capps, as you look at the big picture, what's the immediate thought that's going through your mind?
Holy crap. I was 7 years old and I went to my first drag race. And people said, is this something that you dreamed about? I just thought somebody let me drive their Nitro car. Come up here, Don. This is the guy that made it all possible for all of his teams.
Great job. I love you, Don.
It hasn't sunk in yet. I don't think it's going to sink in for a long time. And it went out. We went out with a little more of a whimper than a bang. It would have been great to see the Valvoline and Napa cars in the final. I just, to do it in front of the home crowd, it's a little bit surreal right now. I'm not quite sure when it'll sink in. You can call me tomorrow.
Jack is the new champion, but how about the guys that helped get him there?
I don't know if I can hold that. Fast Jack Beckman, driver of the Valvoline Next Gen Schumacher Electric Dodge Charger. These are the 9 big brains and 18 hands that take good care of me.
Terry Snyder, Salem, Oregon, assistant crew chief.
Hi, I'm Jim Undercoe from Mentor, Ohio, and I do clutch.
Hi, my name is Matthew Thompson from Waldemar, California, and I'm assistant clutch.
Mark Warnick, Laverne, California, bottom end.
Chris Watson from Brownfield, Maine, with blowers and ignition.
Dan Murphy from Monroe, New York. I do the left side cylinder head and racks.
Kyle Weekly, Lima, Ohio, cylinder heads.
Aaron Hess, St. Henry, Ohio, tire and body specialist.
Hi, I'm Todd Smith from Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, crew chief.
Well, the mood down here in the Napa campus is about exactly what you'd expect it to be as Ron Capps goes through it yet again. But, Ron, I followed the car, the tow vehicle with you in it all the way back through the pits, all along the way. People coming out, clapping. Does that take some of the sting out of this?
Oh, it does, definitely. Our fans, they're the best in the world. I mean, not just our Napa fans, but the NHRA fans. They're unbelievable people. To come back and have an ovation like they just gave us was crazy. I mean, there's bigger things in the world to worry about, I know, but when you want something as bad as we've wanted it, and you wake up in the morning, you go to bed, that's all you think about, and you come close like we have, it makes it tough. I was okay until my daughter Taylor started crying and giving me a hug down there. But you know what? We look back at what we've done this year, and Ron Tober just told me all of our guys are coming back. We're going to have a lot of fun next year. But, I mean, to come down like it did and then have Jack lose right behind us and then just be the 2 points, we're gonna all winter long look back and say, where could we have made those up? And we know where we could have. It's part of it, but best team in the world here with Don Schumacher.
Let's see if we can make you smile one more time. Guys, Ron Capps.
Great moment for Ron Capps despite the loss. Coverage of Monday Night Football continues on ESPN at 6:30. It's Monday Night Countdown served by Applebee's. And then at 8:30, Kansas City takes on Pittsburgh. Monday, 8:30 on ESPN.
You know, there was a time that if Brandon Bernstein made it to a final, he was almost a guaranteed winner. Well, times have changed, and it's been 69 races since Brandon Bernstein has lifted a Wally. But for some reason, he feels like today is going to be different. He says he's going to get his first win for Morgan Lucas Racing. Joe Barlam says they got a car that can do it. And more than anything, he would love to stop Tony Schumacher in his tracks.
Well, I tell you what, if Tony Schumacher does beat Brandon Bernstein in the final and win the championship, it will be because of a yeoman's effort by the U.S. Army team. They have basically rebuilt this car. They have it almost ready for Tony to get back into the cockpit and fired up for the warm-up. Mike Green making some adjustments with his little adjustable knobs there in the clutch and everything. And, if you go back to Tony getting here for this chance to the finals, you go to the semifinal win over Bob Vandegrift. That is a margin of victory of 18 inches. Just how far is that? Well, it's from the tip of my finger down to my elbow. So 18 inches, not very much. Back with more from Pomona right after this.
Back in Pomona, California, this is the Pro Stock Semifinal at the Auto Club of Southern California Finals. It's Vincent Nobile and Erica Enders. As we take a look at the ladder, coming up will be the champion, Alan Johnson and Mike Edwards.
Right now, Vincent Nobile and Erica Enders, the young guns, but Vincent Nobile on the tree, his average reaction time is .001. He had a perfect line in the first round and a 002. That wasn't hard to do the math on that one, Paul.
It might go all the way to 002, 003. I'll tell you what, he might really blow it and go a 004.
015. Still had the advantage off starting line. I don't think it'll be enough for Erica. She's had the car this weekend. Oh, good race.
Wow, that was.
He still gets it on a hole shot. Erica fell off a little bit and he lapsed time. And look at that. His worst reaction time and he gets a win on a hole shot. Nice job.
Where's that old man?
Back in the pits with Antron Brown as he waits and watches and sees his teammate Tony Schumacher move on to the finals with a chance to knock him out of the championship. But Antron, what is the hardest part, the hardest thing about sitting back here waiting and watching?
Just that you don't have no control of anything. You know what I mean? You're just at the wheel, the racetrack, and what the teams do and everything else. And that's the worst situation you want to be at because you have nothing that you can do about it. So. you know, Tony and that Army team, they've been in these situations over and over and over again. So they know how to get it finished. You know, we just had some really bad mishaps happen our way, but, you know, we still had a great race season. So that's what we're taking out of it, you know, and thank God. And that was safe. So all the glory goes to him. And we're just going to go back, regroup, and do what we do. And if we win, we win. If not, we'll come back out next year and just work harder than we did this year.
So it's still a wait for Antron Brown, Alan Johnson, and Mike Edwards. Pro Stock, the other half of the semifinal. They last raced at Bristol when Mike Edwards won. It was so close, they couldn't figure the margin of victory.
Got a little staging duel there. Either driver wanting to go in first. Alan, there goes Alan. He's a champion. He's got nothing to lose. Come on. Almost dead even, but that was all she wrote for Mike Edwards. Alan Johnson just pulls away. Gets the win. 6:52.6 at 211 miles per hour to advance to the final round. Putting icing on the cake.
So the brand new champion, Alan Johnson, goes into the finals against young Vincent Nobile with lane choice.
And in Tony Schumacher's pit, as he gets prepared for the final round, another win could give him another top fuel championship. You notice the canopy is off. They had that problem. The clutch was worn completely out of it. Then they had the engine failure and a lot of other problems. They're having to replace a lot of things, including put a new engine in it, a new throttle cable. Also, you see him working there, doing some grinding, getting things ready so everything will fit properly. Also, a new throttle cable for Tony, and then they'll put the car back together, get it out there, and hope that they've done a good enough job to win this team another title. But remember, Tony says they thrive under pressure. Well, this is a very good test for that.
So Pro Stock Motorcycle there on the line, closest to you, Ellie Tonglet. He's raced in one final round this season at Chicago when he lost to Andrew Hines. But take a look at the ladder for this semifinal matching. For Pro Stock Motorcycle, Andrew Hines and Matt Smith will be coming up in a moment. Right now, it's Ellie Tonglet as he faces our newly crowned Pro Stock Motorcycle champion, Eddie Krawick.
Oh, Ellie loses. Eddie Krawick's going to go to the final, the champion. Tell you, with Ellie losing, that'll be the first time since 1987 that no Suzuki has won during the season.
Tuesday on ESPN, four championship coaches headline the State Farm Champions Classic. At 7, Tom Izzo's Michigan State Spartans take on Bill Self's Kansas Jayhawks. And then at 9, Coach K's Duke Blue Devils and John Calipari, the champion Kentucky Wildcats, square off for the first time in 10 years. And at the line now is Andrew Hines and Matt Smith, stat guy.
When you talk about Andrew Hines, you're talking about Vance and Hines. They've won 9 championships in the 26 years of Pro Stock Motorcycle. That's 35%. And remember this one, Eddie Krawick's first championship, no race wins. He's on the verge of 10, which would tie Matt Hines, who walks back at the motorcycle, with a single season all-time record.
Matt Smith. His only final round this year, 2 weeks ago in Las Vegas, he lost to Eddie Krawick at that time. Now he faces Krawick's teammate.
Oh, man, that's problems
for Harley. Well, for Harley, with Matt Hines aboard, that is their 15th race win of this season. What a year it has been for the Screaming Eagles. And now they will face one another in the finals. Andrew Hines and the new champion, Eddie Krawick. Andrew is going to have the lane choice. All of the finals for the last race of the season are about to come up. One champion to be decided. Can Tony Schumacher get his 8th championship? Or will it be Antron Brown with his first? If it is, Antron Brown is the first African-American to win an NHRA title. ESPN's presentation at the Automobile Club of Southern California Finals is brought to you by Full Throttle Energy Drink. Grab a Full Throttle Energy Drink and feel the energy at work. The Auto Club, we're always with you. And Lucas Oil, the world leader of high-performance lubricants and problem-solving additives for everyday cars and trucks. To the applause of the NHRA fans, Jack Beckman celebrates his first championship as the Funny Car Champion. One more championship yet to be decided. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series concludes next weekend with the battle for the championship. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series, Ford 400 at Homestead, Miami. Next Sunday, coverage begins at 1:30. Now, it's time for our Full Throttle hardworking crew.
And in top fuel, it's the Army team for getting their driver, Tony Schumacher, in position to possibly get his eighth career top fuel championship. Then in Funny Car, it's got to be that Valvoline team of Jack Beckman, led by crew chief Todd Smith and Terry Snyder, for getting Jack his first career championship. Pro Stock, Alan Johnson and Dad Roy have been trying to do this for 17 years. Boy, that hard work paid off. A well-deserved championship for Alan. And then in Pro Stock Motorcycle, it's the motorcycles. Eddie Krawick gets the championship, but if he wins, it would be his 10th win this season, and it would tie the Pro Stock Motorcycle record for single-season victories.
Well, the sun has gone down. It's dark in Pomona, and here come the finals. We begin with Pro Stock Motorcycle, the Harley side-by-side, Eddie Krawick and Andrew Hines.
Paul, stop me if you heard this before. Well, actually, don't, because you have heard it before. It's the Harley-Davidson number one and two qualifiers in the final round. Andrew Hines has a slight advantage from the performance standpoint. Eddie Krawick, though, your Full Throttle champion for 2012. As we mentioned, if he gets this win, it would be his 10th of the season, and that would tie the record by his crew chief, Matt Hines.
Yeah, for single season Pro Stock Motorcycle record.
He might be who gets off the line first.
That's close.
Yeah.
It's close.
Slight advantage to Eddie.
Pro Stock Motorcycle, Andrew Hines comes up with the win. Track record ET, 676 with a 698.29 miles an hour.
Ah, they must have just unleashed her, because look at Andrew just carrying that front end. There was no contest. He had the better bike all weekend long with a good reaction time. He gets the win.
Andrew Hines, you told us at the start of this weekend that you threw combinations at this bike that you had never done before after totally reworking the machine. Obviously, it worked out oh so well. Did you dare believe it could be this good to run a 76 in the final?
I never thought it'd be this good, but hats off to the NHRA safety safari. They did an awesome job preparing the track after that alcohol dragster oiled it down, but gave me the utmost confidence. You know, it was in my lane, but I wasn't worried. They do an awesome job giving us a great track week in, week out. So, you know, the motorcycle ran great. The V-Rod's running fantastic. It's just another dream season that we had. And, you know, it's not really about this. It's all about the veterans out there. You know, we Eddie and I are honored to tag along with Summit Racing Equipment over to Europe and visit some of the military bases over in Bosnia, Kosovo, and Germany. So we're going to go on Operation Appreciation. So I want to dedicate this Wally to all the veterans out there. You guys are the ones that allow us to come out here and compete and have fun. And luckily, I'm just the guy in the seat and getting the accolades right now. So it's just a great deal. Hats off to Eddie for winning the championship. Luckily, I got another Wally to end the season. Great win.
Career number 31 breaks that tie with your brother. I know that means something, too.
Yeah, that's great. Congratulations.
Alan Johnson, Vincent Nobile, Pro Stock Final. Johnson finishes the year out with a championship and a win. A 652, 212 miles an hour.
That's making a statement. It was Roy Johnson horsepower in both cars in the final round. They couldn't lose either way, but Alan Johnson wanted to seal the deal. Look how close it was at the stripe. Nice job.
At the starting line, Antron Brown continues to watch and wait to see if he'll be the champion. The only way he will be is if that man, Tony Schumacher, fails to win the final. We'll be right back. The Nitro Finals are about to begin at the Auto Club of Southern California Finals. Antron Brown is waiting to find out if he will be the Top Fuel champion. Or look at Tony Schumacher coming forward with his crew. Will he be the champion? Funny Car on the track right now. Let's go to Gary Gerald.
Waves of emotion sweeping over Alan Johnson. What a way to put a period on an amazing season, the championship, the final Wally of the year. By how much did you exceed your expectations this season, Alan?
Oh, Lord, help. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We're so blessed. You know, I don't know if we exceeded them, but we met them. You know, having a great season like this, it ranks right up there with one of the greatest seasons ever in pro stock. And for us, our little backcountry team to do this, you know, we've just got great sponsors with Mopar. We've got great team with Mark and Jim and Mike and Jason and Matt and Dean. And I mean, it's just on and on, Rick and Tracy. You know, thank God to my wife for letting me do this, putting up with me. Dad, another one. Mom.
Courtney Forrest, will she score as the rookie of the year at the banquet tomorrow night? She faces Cruz Pedregon. His only race win at the finals was in 2008 when he won the championship. Cruz is gone. Goodbye. Boy, was that a run. Cruz Pedregon, a 403, 306 miles an hour, and he has done it here at the finals for the second time.
Take a look at Courtney. Problems. Did something happen to the car as soon as she stepped on the throttle? Cruz got close to the wall, but nice pass to get the win.
Cruz Pedregon, the first win of this season, the first with Lee Beard, the 30th of your career, ties you with Kenny Bernstein, number five all time. How satisfying for you is this moment?
Well, it's very satisfying. I tell you, it's on Veterans Day. We say hey to all the veterans. And I tell you what, I can't say enough about Full Throttle. You know, we all thank our sponsors, but Full Throttle, Coca-Cola for being behind us, and they're coming out with a Mellow Yellow brand. I tell you what, this means everything to me. And, you know, I'm kind of tired today, man. This is, really a special win, Lee and the team, and really Snap-on for sticking behind me, all the franchisees. You know, we're really getting things going, and Masters of Metal guys, you know, everybody, you know, I do want to say, I hate to see Herzog leave. Herzog's been supporting us for 7 years, and I think they're going to leave. Stan Herzog, man, we love you and been a big part of this, but boy, this is a way to cap the year off, man. I'm so excited, guys. I'll tell you what, I'm really kind of speechless, but this goes to show you just hang in there. We left so many races on the table this year. This is a hell of a car. It's a bad Jose car right here, man. Thank you, guys. All right.
The Top Fuel Final. This is for the championship. If that man, Tony Schumacher, wins, he is the champion for an eighth time. But Antron Brown, if Tony Schumacher loses, becomes the first African-American to win an NHRA title. Brandon Bernstein is in the other lane.
Right now, Antron Brown has to depend on Brandon Burns, who hasn't won in 3 years, 69 races ago. You look at the most championships in NHRA history. Tony has seven. This would be his eighth. But now, the one thing you got to remember, too, is he can't oil down the racetrack. We bring that up because he had an oil-down penalty in qualifying. If he oils the track down because of that one penalty, he would get a 20-point deduction, which would basically take away that win. So he's got to win the round, and it's got to be clean.
Right lane has been favored in Top Fuel. 10 there, 4 in the left. But Tony Schumacher has decided the left lane is the place to be. Against Brandon Bernstein, Tony Schumacher is 8-2 in final rounds. But don't count out Brandon. He's got a 69-race slump, as Mike said.
Mike Green, Tony Schumacher's crew chief, told me a little while ago that this, the plan right here, race the racetrack. In other words, make the best run you can based upon the conditions. In that semifinal round, they underestimated how good the track would be, and they had that problem, got lucky. The track is tightening up. He says right here, we're going to make our best run of the weekend.
It's for the championship. Antron Brown can do nothing about it. It's all up to Tony Schumacher. In just a few seconds, we'll know who is the Top Fuel champion.
Oh, look at that!
Brandon Bernstein! 376, Antron Brown is the Top Fuel champion! A long way wait for the very likable Antron Brown, and he has his first Top Fuel championship, his first championship in the NHRA. Remember, he started in Pro Stock Motorcycle.
About that. Let me tell you something. When you compete Tony Schumacher on a whole shot in a final round, you've done your job. And look at the margin of victory at the stripe. Just a great drag race to end the season.
I don't know who's going to be happier, Antron for taking the championship or Brandon Bernstein for breaking that 69-race slump. His last win, Mike told you, at Richmond 2009. And that win was over Antron Brown.
Tony Schumacher digesting the fact that he has lost the championship on a hole shot, and as the helmet came off, I heard you say it's a terrible way to lose. Elaborate, if you would.
There's no good way to lose. You know, most of those hole shots are about where you stage the cars, but great car. Mike gave me a good car. You know, it felt great. Got to the end. Wind light did not come on, and I never saw him or heard him. It had to be inches. Had to be a phenomenal race. You know, I'm sure Antron's back there celebrating. We gave the fans what they came for, and would have really liked to see on Veterans Day, you know, the Army car win, and just a disappointment. I'm sure my light wasn't bad. I felt like
it was a 54 for you, a 37 for
you know, and I'm sure the 60 foots will show the difference there. That was a great light for him, man. A 54, you can't do much better than that. You go out and take a shot like that, win the race, man. Hats off to him. The guy's been a long time since they've won, and just a disappointing way to win. A 50 light would have beat almost everybody.
Thanks, Tony.
Don Schumacher, you win regardless. The second time you've got both Nitro champions, an emotional final. How do you put this one into words, watching your team win a championship while watching your son just miss out on one?
I feel terrible for Tony, but Brandon did a heck of a job out there. The whole Army team did a great, great job out there running low ET of the day. Fantastic race. Just didn't get the job done. And Antron winning the championship, he's a very deserving champion, as that whole Matco Tools U.S. Army team is.
And down at the far end with the race winner, not the champion, but you and Antron Brown, I know, are friends now. He probably considers you his best friend. Brandon, it's been a long time coming this year. Congratulations.
Man, thank you so much. It has been. And, yeah, Antron and I are good buddies. And, you know, it's just this MAV-TV team, Protect the Harvest team, I mean, we've worked so hard all year long, and we've been so close so many times. And this is just for these guys. They worked so, so hard. Lucas Oil, Toyota, all of our sponsors, man, they've just been awesome all year. And it's been a long, long time. But this feels awesome right now. It is so cool right now. Thank you.
Nice job, Randy.
Thanks.
Well, yeah! We finally caught up with our Top Fuel champion. It's been amazing what has gone on since then. You're on a express train right now to the press room. Take it all in, soak it all in.
Dave, the thing about it is we have an incredible race team with this Matco car. And the thing about it is that the good Lord was looking out. And he knew that we have a team that's capable of winning races week in and week out. But he just wanted to let us know and show everybody out there that he has control, and he made that happen. And
what was going through your mind when you watched that run?
My mind was just, I was just staying calm, being poised, because Tony's our teammate. And he's got a car that can run, can set world records. And Mike Green and them did a great job, and they stole it in 2009. And I was like, here it goes again. I mean, Tony does the Cinderella stories like they're nothing. And our guys are sitting back, and the worst feeling of it is that you like to have control, like do what you can do. And it was out of our control. I mean, we had little things that broke that never break. It wasn't a tune-up, wasn't a driving issue, just a little faulty part broke. And man, just to get a championship, I'm speechless right now. I'm speechless. I'm just so honored to drive for all the people that we represent, from Matco, the U.S. Army, Aaron's, Valvoline, Toyota, all the great people that put this together, for my team owner, Don Schumacher. I mean, we wouldn't be nowhere without Don. I mean, he has mega house teams, and that's why you get voted in the Hall of Fame, because of things like that. Three teams and the funny car. It's been an incredible year, and it's just to come out on top of all that competition. Brother, I'm running out of words for once, and I could talk a marathon, but it's just been a great day, and I love everybody out there. And it's just been one of those wonderful days. All of our family back in New Jersey, our Louisiana family, Billy Joe's grandma, I'll never say hello to you. We love you too. And my grandma back at home that went through Sandy, all my family. This is what it's all about, man. You go through that, and we came out on top on strong. It's been a great, great 2012 year.
By just 7 points, Antron Brown is the Top Fuel champion.
The season has come to an end, and congratulations to all of our new champions and to the NHRA for a great year. For all of our announcers this year, Gary Gerald, Dave Reif, John Kernan, Jamie Howe, the stat guy, Lewis Bloom, Mike Dunn, and the best telecast team ever, I'm Paul Page, saying thanks for joining us this year and watching. The NHRA Mellow Yellow Drag Racing Series will return in February right here in Pomona, California. Up next, NASCAR Now.